I'm JP from the Way Biblical Fellowship, and this week's Torah portion is Ki Tisa. And in it, we have a look at the idea of worshipping Yahuwah, how we are to worship Him. What happens when we pick a way to worship Him that is not in accordance with how He wants to be worshipped? He tells us very specifically how we should worship Him, and yet people come up with their own ideas. So we look at how he feels about that. We also look at what it is to walk in the Spirit. Look at the attributes of the Spirit that Yeshua had upon him. Wisdom, understanding, knowledge, counsel, strength, the fear of Yahuwah. And we look where Scripture tells us that those things come from. So we try to understand what walking in the Spirit actually is, as opposed to the false doctrine that has been taught. We look at the incident with the golden calf. And we look again at that sort of worship which seems pleasing to men, but is not pleasing to Yahuwah. We look at Moshe coming down from the mountain, breaking the tablets, going back up, getting another two, and what that symbolizes for us in our life. So I hope that you enjoy it. Okay, the Torah portion is Ki Tisa. That's a bit loud, isn't it? Is that any better? That loud enough? Yeah, cool. All right, well, the Torah portion is Ki Tisa. And it means when you take. It's taken from the first passage in this, the second verse. It says, "And Yahuwah spoke to Moshe, saying, when you take the census of the children of Israel," and really in the Hebrew it is when you lift up to count the children of Israel. So when you take the census of the children of Israel to count them, then each one shall give an atonement for his soul to Yahuwah when you count them, so that there is no plague among them when you count them. Okay, so at any time that they counted the children of Israel, they would all have to pay this half shekel as an atonement for their souls before the Lord. Otherwise, a plague would come upon them, as we saw with David. It says, "Everyone among those who are counted is to give this half a shekel according to the shekel of the set-apart place, 20 gerahs being a shekel." The half shekel is the contribution to Yahuwah. So 10 shekels, it was called a becker, it was half a shekel. Sorry, 10 gerahs was half a shekel. Everyone passing over to be counted from 20 years old and above gives a contribution to Yahuwah. The rich does not give more, and the poor does not give less than half a shekel when you give a contribution to Yahuwah to make atonement for yourselves. Okay, so the atonement that is paid for everyone is exactly the same. Just as with Yeshua, when he pays for our atonement, doesn't matter who you are. Okay, God is not a respecter of persons. It doesn't go by that. "And you shall take the silver for the atonement from the children of Israel and give it for the service of the tent of meeting. And it shall be to the children of Israel for a remembrance before Yahuwah to make atonement for yourselves." Now this will be relevant to people who are in the end times, whether it's us or to a future generation, because we see the 144,000 are counted, 12,000 from each tribe. That's a census. That is the children of Israel being counted at that point. So they all have to have an atonement made for their souls. Now, for those people, Yeshua pays their atonement. But there are a group of people in Revelation, and it says that they cannot be counted. It's not that God's up there going, oh, there's just too many of them. I wish that they'd stop moving around. Can't count them. They can't be counted. It's not according to Torah for them to be counted. They will pay the atonement in a different way. This is called the head tax. It's when you lift up, the head. And there's two different ways of having our heads lifted up. We can be counted by Yeshua, and we can be sons and daughters of Yeshua, or we can have our heads lifted up in a different way in the end times. And that is how the atonement is paid by these other group of people. But I'm not going to go into detail about that. There's a lot of information that I could go into. Well, if that interests you, I recommend you have a look at these two. Okay? These two teachings go into this in depth. They look at all of the scriptures. We will make reference to this concept as we go through the Torah, when things like silver and seeking things like silver are mentioned, as we'll see in a verse later. So it's important to understand this, but so as to not put another half an hour onto this teaching, I just say, go and watch it on the YouTube channel. Well worth your time. Okay, verse 17 says, and Yehovah spoke to Moshe saying, and you shall make a basin of bronze with its stand also of bronze for washing, and you shall put it between the tent of meeting and the altar, and shall put water in it. Okay, so this is the bronze laver. This is where the priests would have to wash before they came into the holy place. And we've looked before at the whole idea of washing in the water of the word. That's something that we're familiar with. Again, it's not something that I'm going to go into now. It says, and Aharon his sons shall wash from it their hands and their feet when they go into the tent of meeting, or when they come near the altar to attend to burn an offering made by fire to Yehovah. They wash with water lest they die. If they didn't do this, they would die because they were coming into the holy place. If you think of when Moshe, when he saw the burning bush, he was told to take his sandals off his feet because it was holy ground. Now that was a place where the messenger or the angel of Yehovah was just there for a brief period of time, and he was told, take your sandals off your feet, okay? Have bare feet because you're on holy ground. This is talking about a place where Yehovah's presence, his physical manifest presence, is going to dwell. He's going to make that place holy, and he knows that it's dangerous for something that is unclean to come into the presence of something that is holy, because there's another step in between, okay? You've got the unclean and you've got the clean, then the next step is it being made holy. Just for something that is unclean to come into the presence of something that it's holy can cause death. We see that throughout the Torah, and this is why Yehovah says to do these things. And they shall wash their hands and feet lest they die, and it shall be a law forever to them, to him and his seed throughout their generations. And Yehovah spoke to Moshe saying, and take for yourselves choice spices, 500 shekels of liquid myrrh, and half as much, 250 of sweet-smelling cinnamon, and 250 of sweet-smelling cane, and 500 of cassia, according to the shekel of the set-apart place, and a hin of oil. And you shall make from these a set-apart anointing oil. Okay, when we read set-apart, it's holy, it's kadosh. And again, it's this thing of, look, we are in a state of uncleanness. We've got to be made clean, and then we've got to be made holy. For this to be set apart, it's different from what's within the world. Okay, it's different in nature to what's in the world. If something is made holy, it is set apart, it is special. The most holy thing is Yehovah. Yehovah is completely separate from this world. Okay, he created this, so he is as set apart from this world as you can get. A compound blended, the work of a perfumer. It is a set-apart anointing oil. And with it you shall set apart the tent of meeting and the ark of the witness, and the table and its utensils, and the lampstand and its utensils, and the altar of incense. So contain these ingredients, okay? 500 shekels of liquid myrrh, 250 of sweet cane, 250 of cinnamon, 500 of cassia, and a hint of olive oil. The altar of burnt offering with all its utensils. Okay, these are all the things to be made holy with this anointing oil. The basin and its stand, and you shall set them apart, and they shall be most set apart. Whatever touches them is to be set apart. Okay, even touching these things makes you holy. It talks about the priest's garments, that they take them off when they come out of service in case they went out into the people and made them holy. Again, this bears an element of danger. Yehovah, the most set apart, if you were to come into his presence, that would increase how dangerous it was, because you'd be coming in a state of extreme uncleanness into the state of extreme holiness. These things have just been made holy. Okay, if something that was unclean came into the presence of them, it wouldn't be as dangerous. There's different levels that we see within the Torah. And you shall anoint Aharon and his sons and set them apart to serve as priests to me, and speak to the children of Israel, saying, this is set apart anointing oil to me throughout your generations. It shall not be poured on the flesh of a man, and make no other like it according to its composition. It is set apart, it is set apart to you. Whoever compounds any like it, or whoever puts any of it on a stranger, shall be cut off from his people. So even creating this, we might think, oh, it's fine, it's just a mixture. Okay, we create it, we've read about it in the Torah, it's not going to do any harm. Now this is set apart, the Lord set this apart for a particular purpose. We see the same with the incense here. It says, and Yehovah said to Moshe, take sweet spices, fragrant gum and cinnamon and galbanum and clear frankincense, with these sweet spices all in equal amounts. Then you shall make of these an incense, compound work of perfumer, salted, clean, set apart. And you shall beat some of it very fine and put some of it before the witness in the tent of meeting where I meet with you. It is most set apart for you. And the incense which you make, do not make any for yourselves according to its composition. It is set apart to you for Yehovah. Whoever makes any like it to smell it, he shall be cut off from his people. So if people look at the instructions of Torah and they go, I bet that incense is amazing, the stuff that they use in the temple, we're going to make that just to see what it's like. That is really, really extreme in Yehovah's eyes. He says they are to be cut off from the people. Now, incense is something that is we've had as an issue within the fellowship recently. I spoke to Charlie, I spoke to Joe, and we came to the conclusion that it was not good to be burning incense at a time when we come and we meet with the Lord. He's got a set apart way of doing it. And I want to show you this passage of scripture. I put this image in actually because people have their own way of coming to the Lord, okay? And they think that it's worship to enter in a certain way, okay? But the Lord's got a set apart way of doing it. So in Isaiah 65, 2-7, it says, I have held out my hands all day long to a stubborn people who walk in a way that is not good after their own thoughts. Okay, this entire passage is about people doing things in a certain way that they think is right, they think should be acceptable before the Lord, but it's not what the Lord has asked for, okay? And he tells us exactly how he feels about this here, okay? People come before the Lord and they think, oh, this is fantastic. Look at us all in our dress that we've come up with. This is honoring to the Lord. We all get together and we all have this certain way of doing things. I bet that God loves this. Okay? He said, no, I don't love it. The people who provoke me continually to my face, who sacrifice in gardens. We might think, okay, in the back garden, we'll offer up something. We'll offer up peace offerings to the Lord. Okay, we're not going to sacrifice animals. We'll offer up a peace offering to the Lord in the garden. That must be acceptable before him. He says, no, the people who do this are a smoke in my nose, as we'll see. Now, this is something that I should mention here. Somebody got in touch recently and they were asking about, well, should I make offerings in the garden to the Lord? Would that be a nice thing to do? The people that the Lord is angry with are the people who just presume and take it upon themselves to do all of these things. Okay, I'm not talking about that. To seek out whether or not that's the right thing to do, that's fine. These people, they've just come up with their own system of worship before the Lord. And burn incense on altars of brick. Okay, this is particularly offensive to him. Okay, he says that an altar to him should be of unhewn stone. It shouldn't be shaped by man's hand. We see when they're told, when you go over the land, over into the land to build Joshua's altar, they're told, put a plaster on the outside of it, but make it with unhewn stone. Here we can see, okay, marble altar made of hewn stone. And what are they doing? They're burning incense before the Lord. Now this can seem like an amazing religious show. Oh, look how amazing they are. They've dedicated their lives to the Lord, but they haven't. They've just turned their ear away from his instructions, which are very plain, very clear. If they had just read his word, they would have known that this is wrong. But they do this anyway, because they're not interested in what the Lord has got to say. Who sit among the graves, okay? Think of how many churchyards are, or how many churches are full of graves, surrounded by graveyards, okay? The Torah says that this makes a person unclean. To come into contact with death, it makes them unclean. They call these the houses of God, where they expect the presence of God to come and dwell amongst them. And yet they surround it with death. They surround it with the unclean. They completely disregard and ignore all of the instructions, which are very plainly set out for them. If they just read it, they'd know this is wrong. They might have an excuse like, oh, after Jesus has come, all of this has been done away with. If you think about that, if you think about the mechanical process of this makes it unclean, this makes it a place where God cannot come and dwell, then Jesus coming and dying on the cross couldn't have changed that at all. But people don't care. They just read scripture and then they have their own interpretation. They want to read into scripture. They want to form a God according to their own imagination, according to what they think should be right, do what is acceptable in their own eyes. Who eat the flesh of pigs. Okay, this is a great one. This is a vicar on Come Dine With Me, serving up a nice rack of pork ribs here, okay? And the broth of unclean meat is in their pots. This is an abomination before the Lord. All that is required is to just read it and say, oh yeah, the Lord says not to do that. We won't do it anymore. Who say, keep to yourself. Do not come near me, for I am set apart to you. In a lot of translations, this says, I am holier than thou. But this is a better translation of it. I'm set apart to you, because to be kadosh, to be holy, is just to be set apart from something. So they are holy from the Lord. He's set himself apart, and they've set themselves apart from him by choosing a different way. See, it is written before me, I am not silent, but shall repay, and I shall repay into their bosom. Okay, and we'll see exactly what that's going to look like and exactly what situation they're in when they've chosen what does not please the Lord in a bit. Your iniquities and the iniquities of your fathers together, said Yehovah, who burned incense on the mountains and reproached me on the hills, and I shall measure their former work into their bosom. Okay, they were told, burn incense in a particular place. Do it in this way in the worship of me. So just to explain, this is why we've discussed it and we decided not to have that a part of any kind of worship of the Lord. Jeremiah 6:20 says, what need have I of frankincense from Sheva and sweet cane from a distant land? Your burnt offerings are not acceptable and your sacrifices have not been sweet to me. So whether it was because they were just doing these things and they weren't following the rest of the law, or because they were doing these things in a way that was not prescribed, this is the Lord's attitude to these things. So chapter 31 says, and Yehovah spoke to Moshe saying, see, I have called by name Bezalel, son of Uri, son of Hur, of the tribe of Yehudah. And I have filled him with the spirit of Elohim in wisdom and in understanding and in knowledge and in all workmanship to make designs for work in gold and in silver and in bronze and in cutting stones for setting and in carving wood and to work all work. And I have appointed him with Holiab, son of Ahizamach of the tribe of Dan. And I have put wisdom in the heart of everyone who is wise-hearted, and they shall make all that I have commanded you. Now this will make sense. This putting wisdom in the hearts of the wise-hearted will go into this. Okay, but notice the elements of the spirit of Elohim that he has: wisdom, understanding, knowledge. We'll look at this one in a little bit. So this is who this guy was. He was Miriam's grandson. Okay, so he was, I think Moses was his great uncle, but this guy's related to Moses. Speaks of him in Exodus 35, 30 to 34 as well. It says, "And Moshe said to the children of Israel, see, Yehovah is called by name Bezalel, son of Uri, son of Chev, the tribe of Yehudah, and he has filled him with the spirit of Elohim in wisdom, in understanding, and in knowledge, and in all workmanship." Okay. This guy is the guy that was to build the temple in Solomon's day. Okay, the pattern of the temple was given to David, but he couldn't build it because he was a man of war. Solomon had to build the temple, okay? Solomon sent and brought Hiram from Soar. He was the son of a widow from the tribe of Naphtali, and his father was a man of Soar, a bronze worker, and he was filled with wisdom and understanding. Okay, so we've got these characteristics. He's filled with the Spirit, and he's filled with these characteristics. We look at Isaiah 11, 1 to 2, it says, "And a rod shall come forth from the stump of Yeshai, and a sprout from his roots shall bear fruit." We know this to be talking of Yeshua, of course. It says, "The Spirit of Yehovah shall rest upon him." And then it describes the elements of the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge, and of the fear of Yehovah. So the six characteristics. These characteristics, okay, wisdom, understanding, and knowledge, were the ones that were given to Bezalel. But there are three other characteristics as well: counsel, might, and the fear of Yehovah. Probably could have done with the fear of Yehovah, since he was one of the ones who didn't enter into the land. If we look at the characteristics that are mentioned here, as you're going through Scripture, when these words are used in Scripture, know that it is talking of the Spirit of God. Okay, depending on the context, sometimes it says man has got wisdom. But when it's somebody who's walking with God and it's saying that they're walking in wisdom, this is what it's saying. It says, "To know wisdom and instruction, to discern the sayings of understanding." Now notice straight off here, it is saying that wisdom comes from instruction. To receive instruction in wise behavior. So these are things that come from the Spirit of God, but we can receive them through the instructions of God. Righteousness, justice, and equity. Okay, what teaches us those things? The Torah teaches us all of those things. To give prudence to the naive, to the youth, knowledge, and discretion. A wise man will hear and increase in learning. Okay, what do you hear? Okay, it's the word of God. And a man of understanding will acquire wise counsel. See, these things we'll see as we look through these scriptures. They're all intertwined with each other. Okay? Fear of God leads to wisdom. It also says fear of God leads to knowledge. It's because they all come from the same Spirit. To understand the proverb and the figure, the words of the wise and their riddles, the fear of Yehovah is the beginning of knowledge. But fools despise wisdom and instruction. Okay. In Acts 5:32, it says, "And we are his witnesses to these matters, and so also is the set apart spirit whom Elohim has given to those who obey him." So we see here, okay, it comes from instruction. Wisdom, understanding, wise behavior comes from instruction. That spirit is given to those who obey him. So it comes from a desire to know Yehovah, to walk in his word, and then he will empower you by his word. He'll empower you to understand his word. He will give you wisdom, understanding, knowledge. He gives you counsel through the word. He gives you strength, power, might through the word. Proverbs 8:1 says, "Does not wisdom call, and understanding lift up her voice?" Okay, and they are all straightforward to him who understands, and right to those who find knowledge. The fear of Yehovah is to hate evil. See, if you were just reading this passage, perhaps you would not pick up on the fact that all of these things come from the Spirit of God, the Spirit that Yeshua walked in. The fear of Yehovah is to hate evil. Okay, this aspect of the spirit is to hate evil. What defines evil? The Torah defines what is evil in Yehovah's sight. Pride and arrogance and the evil way and the perverted mouth I hate. Counsel is mine and sound wisdom. I am understanding. Power is mine. Power, the same word. Okay, sometimes it's translated as strength or might. Sometimes it's power, but it's exactly the same word. In Psalm 119, it says, your testimonies also are my delight. They are my counselors. My soul weeps because of grief. Strengthen me, same word, according to your word. Give me understanding that I may obey your law and keep it with all my heart. Establish your word to your servant at that which produces fear for you. Teach me good discernment and knowledge, for I believe in your commandments. Your commandments make me wiser than my enemies, for they are ever mine. So this is the spirit of Elohim. Okay, these are all the attributes of the spirit of Elohim. But look where they come from. It's not something external from the word. Come from his testimonies, from his word, his law, your word, your commandments, your commandments. Okay, this is where the spirit comes from. This is how we walk in the spirit. We just look at these things and they tell us how to walk in the spirit. They give us wisdom and knowledge and understanding. They give us good counsel. They strengthen us and they increase the fear of the Lord. Ephesians 6:17 says, take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the spirit. Okay, it's the spirit separate to the word of God? No, the spirit which is the word of God. The two are not distinguishable from each other. You can't say that you walk in the spirit, but you don't walk in the word of God. That doesn't make any sense. If you walk in a spirit, but you don't walk according to the word of God, then you're walking by another spirit. You're being led by another spirit. The word makes it perfectly clear for us that to walk by the spirit is to walk by the word of God. Revelation 19:13-15 talks of Yeshua's second coming. It says he is clothed with the robe dipped in blood and his name is called the word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. From his mouth comes a sharp sword. What comes from the mouth of Yeshua? What comes from the mouth of God? The word of God. So that with it he might strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, and he treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God, the Almighty. Okay, this is how the nations are judged. They're judged according to the word of God. The word of God goes forth from Zion. The Torah goes forth from Zion. John 5:45-47 says, Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moshe, in whom you have set your expectation. For if you believed Moshe, you would have believed me, since he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how shall you believe my words? The words of Yeshua are Moshe's words. When Yeshua speaks, he spoke the word of Moshe. This is the word that he will speak when he comes back. It's not Yeshua that's going to accuse us to the Father. He will be the judge. But what we're judged by is Moshe and our response to it. You see that in John 12:47-50. If anyone hears my words, okay, how shall you believe my words if you didn't believe Moshe, the one and the same, but does not uphold them? I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. In his first incarnation, he doesn't come as a judge. In his second incarnation, he comes and judges the world. He who rejects me and does not receive my words has one who judges him. The word that I have spoken shall judge him in the last day. So he comes, sharp sword comes out of his mouth. They're judged by the word of God, and he sits as a judge. Because I spoke not from myself, but the Father who sent me has given me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. Okay? He spoke the same words as Moshe did, the Father's words. And I know that his command is everlasting life. Okay, so he's saying, look, you've got a choice. I'm going to speak these words, and I'm not going to judge you. I came to save the world. I came to give you these words so that you might find salvation. I know that his command is everlasting life. But if you reject it, in the last day, you're going to be judged by the very same word that you rejected. Proverbs 2, 1 to 6 says, "My son, if you will receive my words and treasure my commandments within you, make your ear attentive to wisdom, incline your heart to understanding. For if you cry for discernment, lift your voice for understanding. If you seek her as silver," again, go and watch the teaching, "and search for her as for hidden treasures, then you will discern the fear of Yehovah and discover the knowledge of God." Okay, so all of these things, wisdom, understanding, strength, counsel, knowledge, the fear of Yehovah, all of them, they all come from the word of God. They're not separate from it. Okay, did everyone get that? When people say, "I'm just walking in the Spirit, I don't walk by the word of God, I'm just walking in the Spirit," then that doesn't make sense according to what Scripture says. Okay, these people are deceived, and they might be walking by a spirit, and they might have spiritual experiences, and they feel that they're being led in a particular way. But if they're being led away from the word of God, then they're being led by another spirit. We're warned very, very strongly against walking with another spirit. Paul says, "I fear lest by the subtlety that the serpent deceived Eve, you will be taken away by this other Jesus, by this other gospel, by this other spirit." Okay? "Then you will discern the fear of Yehovah and discover the knowledge of God. For Yehovah gives wisdom. From his mouth," again, what comes from his mouth, "come knowledge and understanding." It's all one. God is one. His word, his spirit, it's all exactly the same. Job 28:28 says, "And to man he said, behold, the fear of Yehovah, that is wisdom. And to depart from evil is understanding." Okay, walking by the Spirit, you're departing from evil, you're walking by the Torah. "The fear of Yehovah is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all those who do his commandments." The conclusion, when all has been heard, is fear God and keep his commandments, because this applies to every person. People will come and they will say as well, "Oh no, we don't do that. That was for those people then." Not true. It denies the word of God. It is true for every person. God's law applies to every single person, and they can either accept it or they can reject it. But they will be judged in the last day by what they reject. Deuteronomy 4, 2 to 8 says, "You shall not add to the word which I am commanding you, nor take away from it." Okay, so today we've got Judaism, which largely adds to the word, piles loads of stuff on top of the word. Then we've got Christianity, which takes away from the word. No, we just follow the Bible. We read what the Bible says, and we do what the Bible says. "That you may keep the commandments of Yehovah your God, which I command you." See, all the way throughout Scripture, he's constantly saying, look, don't add to it, don't take away, just do exactly that. If you do exactly that, you'll be blessed. And all of the people who've said that they followed him all throughout history have just taken the bits that they want and kind of cobbled it together into a religion and said, that's the right way to do it. Yehovah is saying, no, just don't add to it, don't take away, just do that, so that you may do what are the commandments of Yehovah your God. "Your eyes have seen what Yehovah has done in the case of Baal Peor. For all the men who follow Baal Peor, Yehovah your God has destroyed them from among you. But you who held fast to Yehovah your God are alive today, every one of you. See, I have taught you statutes and judgments, just as Yehovah my God commanded me, that you should do thus in the land where you are entering to possess it. So keep and do them, for that is your wisdom and your understanding in the sight of the peoples, who will hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. But what great nation is there that has a God so near to it as is Yehovah our God whenever we call on him?" Okay, this is what our experience is to be like. This is when people look to us. They say, these people have got something. God is so close to them. Whenever they call on him, he's right there for them. But it comes from following his word. We will never have that until we just set his word there and say, this is what I'm going to do because this is what it says. Instead of coming to it and saying, I'm struggling with this. Okay, struggle with it, but struggle on the other side of it. Stop doing it and then struggle with the fact that you're not doing it anymore. You're not struggling with it if you're still doing it. Saw something that James sent me last night by a guy called Rabbi Steve Bergson, I think's his name, isn't it? And he was saying, he was talking about wearing tzitzit, and he was saying, look, if you're not wearing tzitzit, the reason is because you don't want to do it. That's as simple as it gets. You can come up with any excuse, but the reason that you're not doing it is because you don't want to. And if that happens to any kind of sin, anything that is against the word of God, the reason you're not doing it isn't because you're having some great struggle with it. It's because you don't want to do it and you've refused to do it and you've turned your ear from Yehovah. Really serious. We want to be right before Yehovah. We don't want to be in a position where we think, oh, we're almost there. We're just struggling with this one thing. As I say, if you're struggling with something, struggle with it on the other side of having stopped doing it. Struggle to not do it anymore. But don't do it and say that you're struggling with it. For what great nation is there that has a God so near to it as is Yehovah our God whenever we call on him? Or what great nation is there that has statutes and judgments as righteous as this whole law which I am setting before you today? Don't you realize what a treasure this is that we've been given? Perfect law of God, then all we have to do is pick it up and do it and embrace it. Isaiah 47 talks about the opposite of this. It talks about the church today. It talks about the state of the church today. Come down and sit in the dust, O virgin daughter of Babylon. Okay, and if you don't grasp this whole thing of the virgin daughter of Babylon and mystery Babylon and what's going on with Babylon, there's a teaching that's just gone up on the YouTube channel this week called Daniel and Revelation Decoded. I recommend just go and have a look at that. Sit on the ground without a throne, O daughter of the Chaldeans, for you shall no longer be called tender and delicate. You feel secure in your wickedness, and no one sees me. Your wisdom and your knowledge, they have deluded you. It's not the wisdom and the knowledge that comes from the word of God. It is your wisdom and your knowledge. They've deluded you. For you have said in your heart, I am and there is no one beside me. You are wearied with your many counsels. Okay, so they're not getting their counsel from the word of God. Let now the astrologers, those who prophesy by the stars, those who predict by the new moon, stand up and save you from what will come upon you. I saw a video of somebody claiming to be a prophet, and they had a massive auditorium, and they were walking around, they were declaring all of these things, and they were saying, getting everybody to say, I might fall, but I will not fall utterly. They were preaching all of this once saved, always saved nonsense. And they're saying, if you're truly saved, you might fall, you might be sinning, but God will never let you go. Okay? See where they get people. So have those become to you with whom you have labored, who have trafficked with you from your youth. Each has wandered in his own way. There is none to save you. Okay, they go by these things. They go by their own wisdom, by their own knowledge, by their own counsels, or counsels that counsel things that are not in the word of God. Man's wisdom, man's knowledge. Okay, in the end though, there will be none to save those people. Okay, they may look to those things. They may sound great to them. In the moment, it might sound amazing to them. You might think, oh wow, yeah, we're saved. No one will ever take me out of God's hand. That might sound great. And they might get their security from that. They might live their lives being all secure. But when it comes to it, in the day of their calamity, whether that is now in this world, or whether it's when they stood before Yehovah, the transparency of those things will be obvious. They will stand before Yehovah and they will have no excuse because they followed something else. Jeremiah 8:8-9 says, how can you say we are wise and the law of Yehovah is with us? But behold, the lying pen of the scribes has made it into a lie. The wise men are put to shame. They are dismayed in court. Behold, they have rejected the word of Yehovah. And what kind of wisdom do they have? Okay, so this is talking about groups of people that say they're walking by the law of Yehovah. You can think of the Jews, okay? Classic example of this. But you can also think of Christianity, who say, we walk by the law of Yehovah. It's just two laws now. Love God and love your neighbor, just as you want to do it. But we do walk by the law of God. Of course we walk by the law of God. Now, the lying pen of the scribes has made it into a lie, because it's taken the whole law of God and gone, we'll just have this bit of it. That sounds nice, doesn't it? Easy for everyone if we just do this bit? Okay, cool. Be appalled, O heavens, at this, and shudder, be very desolate, declares Yehovah, for my people have committed two evils. They have forsaken me, okay, as expressed in my word. I've told them exactly who I am. They've forsaken that. I am the fountain of living waters. And they've done it to hew for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. These religious systems, okay? Anything that takes the word of God, takes bits out of it, and goes, this is now righteousness in God's eyes. It's a broken cistern, and it cannot hold water. It cannot function for what it was designed to do. Perfect example here, okay? Disney Jesus, okay? Half a gospel. He's come to save you from your sins. Okay, the end. You don't have to do anything after that. He's washed you clean of your sins. Go out into the world and just sin as much as you want. You won't get filthy again. It is an abomination before God. Be appalled, O heavens, at this, and shudder, be very desolate, declares Yehovah. This is serious before Yehovah to take these things, cut them up into chunks, rearrange them as we think that they should be rearranged, and then call it the word of God. Proverbs 24 verse 6 says, for by wise guidance you will wage war, and in abundance of counselors there is victory. We fight in a spiritual war. We know what these things are. Wise guidance, okay, it's counsel. Counselors, we know where these things come from. They come from the word of God. We want to successfully walk in this world, a world where we are surrounded constantly by the enemy, by things that are designed to just get us to submit to the enemy as opposed to submit to God. But we have to take the counsel of the word of God. We have to employ that. It's so imperative that we do that. The enemy will constantly come and try and get us to do just anything that is slightly different. Okay, we saw before how people will do things that are slightly different, and they'll do it in a way that they think is honoring God, but it's the enemy coming in trying to change it, saying, oh, you don't need to follow these instructions exactly. God's going to like how you do this. Of course he's going to like this. He's God. That is a God of our own imaginations, when we think that God is going to like something because we like it. We think it's righteous. God says not to do it in his word. He says to do it in a different way. But we think that's the right way to do it. So we do it in that way. Proverbs 29:15 says, the rod and reproof give wisdom. Okay, this is the counsel again. The rod and reproof give wisdom. But a child who gets his own way brings shame to his mother. Okay, if you give a child their own way all the time, they're going to end up being a brat. Same with us. Same with us, with our father. Okay? If we're just given our own way all the time, we're going to end up being rebellious and just expect to have ourselves pandered to. Yehovah's rod and reproof come from his word. When we read his word, we're confronted with what is the right way to do it. We're confronted with what we're doing wrong. And that brings wisdom. Proverbs 12:1 says, whoever loves discipline loves knowledge. Okay? You read the word of God and you think, I'm doing stuff wrong here. I need to get in line with this. If that is your response to it, or if someone comes to you and says, this is a problem, you shouldn't be doing this. If you love that, if you love the reproof, You love knowledge, okay, which is one of the attributes of the Spirit. But this is the response that all too many have. He who hates reproof is stupid. People do. They take offense. When you speak the word of God to them, they take offense and they say, "You're judging me." We can say the same thing back to them. "I do not judge you, but there's one that will judge you, the word that I have spoken in the last day." Proverbs 9:8 says, "Do not reprove a scoffer, or he will hate you. Reprove a wise man," attribute of the Spirit, "and he will love you." Yeshua tells us who the wise are. Matthew 7 says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in the heavens." Okay, told in Scripture what the will of the Father is. He's not just coining a new phrase here. It's the Torah. Okay, so not everyone who calls me Lord will enter into the kingdom of heaven. Only the ones who do the Torah. "Many shall say to me in that day, 'Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name and cast out demons in your name and done many mighty works in your name?'" Doesn't say few people in that day are going to come to me and they're going to think that they're saved, but they're not. He says many, loads of people are going to come to him on that day and declare that he is Lord. "Then I shall declare to them, 'I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of anomia, of lawlessness, of sin.'" That's the problem here. Okay? This isn't a works-based salvation. We are saved by grace. Okay? We're given grace for our transgressions. But afterwards, if we just continue to walk on in lawlessness, if we continue to walk on in sin, then it says that it's worse for us in that position than it was when we didn't know. "Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and does them shall be like a wise man who built his house on the rock." Again, attribute of the Spirit comes from following the word of God. "He who hears these words of mine, which are the same as the words of Moses, which are the same as the Father's words, and does them, he builds his house on a rock. And the rain came down and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock." People who are not founded on the truth, okay, when persecution or trial comes, there's nothing solid for them to stand upon because they haven't got the truth. They've just got these delusions that really, they, inside, they knew were delusions all along. They knew were just excuses. When the trials come, they've got nothing firm. These people are described as foolish people. "Everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them shall be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rain came down and the floods came and the winds blew and they beat on that house and it fell, and great was its fall." Okay, these people who hate reproof, who hate correction, great will be the fall. Proverbs 13:20 says, "He that walketh with wise men shall be wise." Okay, the wisdom that comes from an attribute of the Spirit. Those people who are walking by the word of God. If you walk with them, you will be wise yourself. "But a companion of fools," okay, who are the fools? The ones who didn't do the word, "shall be destroyed." This is their faith. They are cast into Gehenna. Jeremiah 23:16-17 says, "Thus says Yahuwah Sevaoth, do not listen to the words of the prophets who are prophesying to you. They are leading you into futility. They speak a vision of their own imagination, not from the mouth of Yahuwah." Again, what comes from the mouth of Yahuwah? He's saying it's not in accordance with the word of God. "They keep saying to those who despise me, 'Yahuwah has said, you will have peace.' And as for everyone who walks in the stubbornness of his own heart, they say, 'Calamity will not come upon you.'" Okay, it says, doesn't it, there will come a time when they will not endure sound doctrine, but instead will gather to themselves teachers having itching ears. Teachers who will tell them, everything's going to be fine. I'm not going to speak according to the word of God, but God loves you because that's what I think God should do. People listen to what it says is seductive spirits that come in and try to convince them, "Oh no, it's fine. You're living your life in complete abomination before the Lord, but it's fine. You're one of God's people. You go to church, don't you? You're one of God's people. It's a lie. It's destructive. You say, you will have shalom. But it's a lie. And these people might live their lives and might have shalom. They might have peace in their hearts, but it's a deception. They will not have peace in their hearts in the day of their calamity. And as I say, the day of their calamity might not come in this life. It might come when they're standing before the throne. We need to pray that if there's anything like that in our lives, that the day of our calamity comes in this life, and it doesn't come when we stood before the throne of God, because it's too late to turn around then. Proverbs 28:26 says, he who trusts in his own heart is a fool. Ever heard? Trust your heart. Trust in your heart. No, not what the word of God says. He who trusts in his own heart is a fool. But he who walks wisely in accordance with the word will be delivered. Psalm 11 to 13. For he is satisfied. He has satisfied the thirsty soul and the hungry soul. He has filled with what is good, with righteousness. Charlie prayed before about hungering and thirsting for righteousness. Okay? The soul that hungers and thirsts for righteousness will be filled with what is good. There were those who dwelt in darkness and in the shadow of death, prisoners in misery and chains. You just need to look out at the world that's around. People are prisoners in misery, prisoners in chains, and this is what Yeshua has come to set them free from. And all they need to do is submit to God. They'll be free from all of this. Again, it comes down to this, I'm really struggling with this. I'm really struggling. I'm in misery and in chains. Like, just lay it down. Submit to God. The tempter will flee from you. Because they had rebelled against the words of God and spurned the counsel of the Most High. Job 21:14-16 says, they say to God, depart from us. We do not even desire the knowledge of your ways. Who is the Almighty that we should serve him? And what would we gain if we entreat him? Behold, their prosperity is not in their hand. The counsel of the wicked is far from me. And verse 23 says, one dies in his full strength, being wholly at ease and satisfied. Again, they can die. They can have peace. They can live their life in a peaceful way and think that everything's great. Think of the vicar on Come Dine With Me with his pork. Everything's going swimmingly in their life. Everything's fine. In the back of their minds, all of them know something's wrong. Something is... When I went to church, the first time that I went to church, I remember just thinking how dead it was and thinking, when I read the words of Scripture, I read about a powerful God. And in this place, it's just dead. There's no life here whatsoever. I knew that the words of Scripture were true, but I knew there was no life there. And when I was looking at the picture of that vicar, I was thinking, he must think this every day. He must think my life is such a lie. So they die in their full strength. They're wholly at ease and satisfied. Deuteronomy 32:15 says, but Yeshurun, that is the poetic name for Israel. But Israel waxed fat and kicked. Thou art waxen fat, thou art grown thick, thou art covered with fatness. Then he forsook God, which made him, and lightly esteemed the rock of his salvation. We're told about trampling underfoot the blood of the covenant wherewith we are sanctified. They are a nation lacking in counsel, and there is no understanding in them. Okay? Take away the word of God, this is going to be the outcome. Proverbs 1:20-26 speaks of all of these people, all of the people that we've looked at. There's wisdom shouts in the street. She lifts up her voice in the square. At the head of the noisy street, she cries out. At the entrance of the gates in the city, she utters her sayings. But nobody's listening. She's screaming these things out. She's screaming how righteous and holy they are. to do these things, but no one's listening. Everyone's getting on with their own lives. How long, O naive ones, will you love being simple-minded? And scoffers delight themselves in scoffing, and fools hate knowledge. Turn to my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit on you. I will make my words known to you. You think, well, that sounds good. He's going to pour out his spirit on them and make his words known to them. Sounds like something I'd like to happen. Bear in mind, these are people who are scoffing at his word, who will not listen when wisdom is screaming out these things. And they just, oh, we haven't got time for it. Because I called you and you refused, I stretched out my hand and no one paid attention. This is Yehovah speaking to the world here. And you neglected all my counsel and did not want my reproof. I will also laugh at your calamity. I will mock when your dread comes. When your dread comes like a storm and your calamity comes like a whirlwind, when distress and anguish come upon you, then they will call on me, but I will not answer. They will seek me diligently, but they will not find me. Again, might not happen in life. Can you imagine what it would be to be stood before the Lord and for all of that confidence that you'd had in nonsense, all of those things that you put store in your life, for all of that just to be gone? And for you to have no hope with the Lord, because he's called out to you and he's constantly said to you, this is the right way to do it. Walk in this way. And you've just constantly turned your ear from it or deluded yourself with something and just, oh, I'll concentrate on that another time. And all of that is gone when your fear and dread comes upon you, which will happen in that moment, for the Lord to be in derision of you. They would not accept my counsel. They spurned all my reproof. So they shall eat of the fruit of their own way and be satiated with their own devices. Galatians 5 talks of something we need to understand here. It talks of the fruit of the Spirit. And people like to, you know, Christianity, oh, the Spirit, it's something different to the Word. I've got the fruits of the Spirit. I'm a nice person, and you know, I've got joy and peace and love and all of that sort of stuff. It says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. People read this and they think, oh, well, yeah, we don't need the law anymore. We just walk in the Spirit. We've just got the fruits of the Spirit, and there's no law against that, so we're great. But look where these things come from. We've spoken many times about love coming as a fruit of following the Torah. It tells us how to love God and how to love our neighbors as ourselves. For joy, it says, for he gives wisdom and knowledge, attribute to the Spirit, and joy to a man who is good in his eyes. Okay, what's doing good in his eyes? Doing his Torah. He gives joy to that man. It's a fruit of walking in the Spirit. Jeremiah 15:16 says, your words were found and I ate them, and your word was to me the joy and rejoicing of my heart. That's where it comes from. It's from his word. It comes from submission to his word. You see, his word will either be to people, it will either be joy because they've fully embraced it and they're living life in that way and they finally are free of sin in their lives, or it will be a reproof to them. And the people have choice at that point. Okay, they can be reproved by the word of God and they can love that reproof and turn, or they can turn their ears. They can hate that reproof. John 15:10-11 says, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Again, not talking about two sets of commandments. He's saying, if you keep my commandments, as I have kept my Father's commandments, if you follow me when I follow the Father, same commandments. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you and that your joy might be full. That's why the word of God is preached, to give joy, to give freedom from those things which drag us down. Psalm 119:165 says, great peace, fruit of the Spirit, great peace have those who love your Torah, and for them there is no stumbling block. Proverbs 31:26, she shall open her mouth with wisdom, and on her tongue is the Torah of kindness. Fruit of the Spirit, kindness. 2 Chronicles 35:26 says, and the rest of the acts of Yeshua and his kindness according to what was written in the Torah of Yehovah. Psalm 33:4-5 says, for the word of Yehovah is straight, and all his works are in truth, loving righteousness and judgment. The earth is filled with the goodness of Yehovah. Okay, we want to bear the fruit of the Spirit. We want to have this goodness in our lives, and it's done in accordance with the word of God. Ecclesiastes 9:18 says, wisdom is better than weapons of war, but one sinner destroys much goodness. Okay, fruit of the Spirit, walking in his word, is to have goodness. One sinner destroys much goodness because they're walking contrary to the word. Think about how much goodness in this world that we are surrounded with, a world full of sinners, is destroyed in the eyes of Yehovah. Psalm 119:86 says, all your commands are faithful. Okay, faithfulness, one of the fruits of the Spirit. All his commands are faithful. They have persecuted me with lies. Help me. Ephesians 5:9, one of the lesser quoted verses about the fruit of the Spirit, says, the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness. We've just seen where goodness comes from. And righteousness. All your commands are righteousness and truth. Your law is truth. So Exodus 35:31 talks about this guy, Bezalel. We're talking about him being filled with these elements that we've just seen exactly where they come from. He has filled him with the Spirit of God in wisdom, in understanding, in knowledge, so that he can follow the word of God, so that he can follow the instructions that were given by Yahuwah, and in all workmanship. So what was Bezalel doing? Okay, Bezalel was building the tabernacle. All these things, and in all workmanship. Proverbs 24:3-4 says, by wisdom, a house is built, his tabernacle. It gives him wisdom. By understanding, it is established. So he gives him understanding. And by knowledge, the rooms are filled with all precious and pleasant riches. This is talking about how a house in general is built. Okay. Ephesians 2:10 says that we are his workmanship, created in Messiah Yeshua for good works, which God hath prepared beforehand so that we would walk in them. And it says that we are built together as a spiritual house. Okay, how are we built together by the spiritual house? We're given the same attribute to the Spirit that were given to make the original tabernacle. The original tabernacle, which was made according to the word of God. Our tabernacle, okay, the temple of the Ruach, again, is made according to the same commandments, according to the same attributes of the Spirit that are needed to build the house which we are built in Messiah. In whom ye also are builded together for an habitation of God through the Spirit. Again, we can't just read over that. Okay, we're built together for a habitation of God. God is to come and dwell inside of us. We build ourselves as a habitation of God according to the Spirit, according to his word, according to all of the instructions so that he can come and dwell in our midst. If we are to destroy the temple, then we will be destroyed as well. So it says, these are the other things that Bezalel is to make, and we'll finish here. The tent of meeting and the ark of the witness and the mercy seat that is on it and all the utensils of the tent, the table and its utensils, the pure gold lampstand with all its utensils and the altar of incense, the altar of burnt offering and all its utensils, the basin and its stand, the woven garments and the set apart garments for Aharon, the garments of his sons for serving as priests, the anointing oil, sweet incense of the set apart place, according to all that I have commanded you they are to do. Again, when we build our temple with all of the individual elements within us, we build it according to the word of God so that it is a set apart place for Yahuwah to come and dwell in our midst so that he can. So we'll take a break there. Okay, in this part, we're going to talk about being Israel, I'm going to talk about the Sabbath day as well. Two very important things. I think sometimes you think, oh, we should keep the Sabbath. But I'm not sure that everybody kind of gets what keeping the Sabbath is according to Scripture. So we'll have a look anyway. Well, verse 12 says, and Yehovah spoke to Moshe saying, and you speak to the children of Israel saying, my Sabbaths you are to uphold by all means, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations to know that I, Yehovah, am setting you apart. Okay, that's what the Sabbath is for. It is a sign so that we know that Yehovah is setting us apart from the world. The world goes on around us. We know that we are set apart through it. And the Sabbath achieves several different things, which we'll have a look at as we go through. But it says, speak to the children of Israel. So first off, it's important for us to realize that we are Israel, that we are grafted in, that we are Yehovah's people, and Israel isn't a country in the Middle East. Will be one day, but what's there at the moment is not Israel in God's sight. Isaiah 56, 2-7 said, blessed is the man who does this, and the son of man who lays hold on it, upholding the Sabbath, lest he profane it, and guarding his hand from doing any evil. So not keeping the Sabbath, not upholding the Sabbath, is to profane it, which means to make it common. It should be holy, it should be set apart, but we actually make it common. We use it for common use. And let not the son of the foreigner who has joined himself to Yehovah speak, saying, Yehovah has certainly separated me from his people. Nor let the eunuch say, look, I am a dry tree. So he's saying, look, don't let the foreigner think that they're not a part of Israel. If they come and they take part in the Sabbath, if they do the covenant, if they follow my Torah, if they turn their hand from doing any evil. For thus said Yehovah to the eunuchs who uphold my Sabbaths and have chosen what pleases me and holds fast to my covenant. Okay, what pleases him, we're told throughout Scripture, what pleases him is us doing his word. Okay. A eunuch, somebody who's had their testicles cut off. So what he's saying is, let no one who wants to come into covenant with me, nobody who wants to keep my Sabbaths, wants to keep my laws, let no one think that they're strange or separated from Yehovah's people. They're welcome as a part of Israel, which is the same position that we're in. Notice, look, this is in Isaiah 56. Old Testament, okay? The Gentiles could be saved in the Old Testament too. To them I shall give in my house and within my walls a place in the name better than that of sons and daughters, better than that of people who are natural born. If they've come in and they've taken my covenant upon themselves, just because someone is natural born, just because someone can say that they are naturally a son and a daughter, they've got a better place than those people. I give them an everlasting name that is not cut off. Whereas the natural sons and daughters, they can just be cut off. Also, the sons of the foreigner who join themselves to Yehovah to serve him and to love the name of Yehovah, to be his servants, all who uphold the Sabbath and not profane it and hold fast to my covenant, them I shall bring to my set-apart mountain and let them rejoice in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices are accepted upon my altar, for my house is called a house of prayer for all the peoples. So this isn't a new thing. People being grafted into Israel, it's not new. In Ephesians 2, 11-13, it says, therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, okay, phrase right there tells us that we're no longer Gentiles anymore. People kind of think of themselves as, oh, I'm a Gentile, I'm a Christian and I'm a Gentile. Doesn't make any sense. If you're in covenant with Yehovah, you're not a Gentile. You are of the nation Israel. So remember you that you once Gentiles in the flesh who are called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands. Okay, so that's the Jews. And they thought, we're a part of this covenant because we are the natural descendants of Abraham. We've been circumcised. These people, they've not been circumcised. We'll call them the uncircumcision. And that was the way that they saw things. We're God's people because we've physically been circumcised. We're living in a way that's completely abhorrent to God, but we are his people. These people, they're the uncircumcised. They're not part of the covenant. And it says that at that time, when we were Gentiles in the flesh, before we come into covenant, at that time we were without Messiah, excluded from the citizenship of Israel, and strangers from the covenants of promise. I'm going to show you one of the covenants of promise in a second, relevant to this. Having no expectation and without Elohim in the world. So when you were Gentiles, you were without Messiah, you were not part of Israel, you were a stranger from the covenants of promise, and you were without Elohim. But now, in Messiah Yeshua, you who were once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Messiah. The blood of Messiah has cleansed us of our sins so that we can now walk in covenant with Yahuwah. And in verse 19 it says, so then, you are no longer strangers and foreigners. Okay, you're not a foreigner from Israel anymore. You're part of Israel, but fellow citizens with the set apart ones. You are part of the household of God through the blood of Messiah and members of the household of Elohim. So verse 14 says, and you shall uphold the Sabbath, for it is set apart to you. Everyone who profanes it shall certainly be put to death. Okay, so we don't do that today because we don't have judges who are able to put people to death. But if we were to call ourselves God's people and we were to enter into covenant with God, then we would be subject to this. This is how seriously God sees it. Okay, the punishment for a thief was less than for somebody who profaned the Sabbath. This is the same punishment as somebody who murders. This is how abhorrent it is to God for us to just take something that he's given us as a precious, holy gift and to say, no, I'm not doing that. I'm going to do my own thing. For anyone who does work on it, that soul shall be cut off from among his people. Okay, so if we are to do work on the Sabbath day, then we are to be cut off from among his people. That's how he sees it. We don't have the consequences of sin immediately in our lives now, so we can get away in our minds with just doing these things. 6 days work is done, and on the seventh is a Sabbath of rest, set apart to Yehovah. Everyone doing work on the Sabbath day shall certainly be put to death. And these consequences, if we don't have it in life now, again, we will have it when we stand before Yahuwah, when we say, I've profaned your Sabbaths. This that you've given me as a sign that I am set apart, I've trampled it underfoot. And the children of Israel shall uphold the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath throughout their generations as an everlasting covenant. It's one of the covenants that we make with God. We're no longer a stranger to this covenant of promise. It is a covenant. It's a promise that we've made to God. It's part of the covenant that we have with him now that we're in Messiah. Between me and the children of Israel, which as we've just seen, we are all the children of Israel, if we keep his Sabbaths, if we keep his Torah and his covenant, it is a sign forever. For in 6 days Yehovah made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. Can anyone relate to that? On the seventh day, do you feel refreshed? Okay. Katie was saying before that she loves coming here on the Sabbath day, that she feels a lift afterwards. Okay, that's what the Sabbath day is for. It's a refreshment for our souls. We come together in community of believers. Okay, again, he who walks with wise men will be wise himself. Okay, so this is the passage of scripture that we've just looked at. And I want to show you something in this passage. Okay, within this passage, there's a chiasm. We know what a chiasm is. The first element, the same as the last element. Second to last, etc. And this chiasm teaches us something in the way that it's worded. See, the first element of the chiasm is, it is a sign. That's at the beginning and at the end, okay? Now we see the way that this chiasm, how it teaches us things. At the beginning of it, it says, it is a sign between me and you. That's in the second person, you, Israel. here at the end of the chiasm, it says, between me and the children of Israel. Okay, it's in the third person when it speaks of the children of Israel. So what we'll start to see forming in this chiasm is at the beginning, it's how things relate to Israel, how they relate to us. At the end of the chiasm, how things relate to Yehovah. Throughout your generations, okay, second person again, throughout their generations, okay, how it relates to Yehovah. You shall uphold the Sabbath, for it is set apart to you. From Yehovah's perspective, and the children of Israel shall uphold the Sabbath to observe the Sabbath. That's what it means to him. Everyone who profanes it shall certainly be put to death, for anyone who does work on it, that soul shall be cut off from among his people. That is how things relate to Israel. To Yehovah, everyone doing work on the Sabbath day shall certainly be put to death. That's how he looks at it. And we've got the central element of the chiasm. 6 days work is done, and on the seventh is a Sabbath of rest set apart to Yehovah. And we can see why that would be the central element. We can see why it would be important. But with this chiasm, it's got something that is inherent in some chiasms, where the central element hasn't got something that is a commentary on it. Okay, the rest act as a commentary. We've got how it works with Israel, how it works with Yehovah. So we've got a commentary on the two sides. The central element doesn't appear to have a commentary. But if we look at the two elements here, first element, to know that I, Yehovah, am setting you apart. And this element, for in 6 days Yehovah made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. We can see that these two elements together form the commentary, the same commentary that we've seen throughout it, where at the beginning it's how it relates to Israel, and at the end it's how it relates to God. How it relates to Israel is 6 days is work is done, the seventh is the Sabbath of rest set apart to Yehovah, to know that I, Yehovah, am setting you apart. That's how it relates to us. To him, it's 6 days rest, 6 days and then seventh day rest, because in 6 days, Yehovah made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh, he rested and was refreshed. That's what it means to him. So we see, just in the structure of the text, it can teach us much more than just what we're reading, because we can read through this and it can seem like, oh yeah, it's already said that before, but it's saying it in a different way. It's teaching us about the nature of the relationship with Yehovah. Genesis 2:1-3, okay, it says here, for in 6 days Yehovah made the heavens and the earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And we learn about that in Genesis 2. It says, thus the heavens and the earth were completed and all their host. But on the seventh day, Elohim ended his work which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And Elohim blessed the seventh day and set it apart, because on it he rested from all his work. That's why he set it apart. There's a period of time. We can't just have every day as a Sabbath. The reason that he's set apart this period of time is because that's when he rested from all his work. And we look to him. We're conformed to his image. We copy him. Exodus 20:8-11. This is where the command is given in the 10 words. It says, remember the Sabbath day to set it apart. 6 days you labor and shall do all your work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of Yehovah your Elohim. You do not do any work. You, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your cattle, nor your stranger that is within your gates. For in 6 days Yehovah made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, Yehovah blessed the Sabbath day and set it apart. This instruction to keep the Sabbath day is the most oft repeated throughout Scripture. It's all the time. It's two times in this Torah portion. It's at the beginning of this Torah portion, and then it's reiterated again at the end. Okay, that's just this Torah portion, but all the way through Scripture, this is made clear that this is so important. People are to be put to death for not keeping the Sabbath day. It's so important. Ezekiel 20:12 says, I also gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign. Notice it's plural, Sabbaths, okay? That's his feast days as well. To be a sign between them and me, to know that I am Yahuwah who sets them apart. That's the means by which they're set apart. Okay, so this is another purpose of the Sabbath. Deuteronomy 5:12-15 says, uphold the Sabbath day to set it apart as Yahuwah your Elohim commanded you. 6 days you labor and shall do all your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of Yahuwah your Elohim. You do not do any work. You, nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your male servant, nor your female servant, nor your ox, nor your donkey, nor any of the of your cattle, nor your stranger that is within your gates, so that your male servant, female servant rest as you do. Okay, we're not to have anyone work for us. This is why going to the shop on the Sabbath is not something that we can do. Okay, because then we're having somebody else work for us. It's up to them if they decide to work on the Sabbath day, but we're not to increase their workload. We're not to go and have them serve us. And this is so important. This is how the Sabbath day is profaned, and this carries the death sentence to do this. And you shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Mitzrayim, and that Yahuwah your Elohim brought you out from there by a strong hand and by an outstretched arm. Therefore, Yahuwah your Elohim commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. We observe it because we were slaves in the land of Egypt. To remember this, we rest from our work because we were slaves. And because he's freed us, we remember that in the Sabbath day. It's so important. Leviticus 23 verse 3 says, 6 days work is done, but the seventh day is a Sabbath of rest, the set apart gathering. You do no work. It is a Sabbath to Yahuwah in all your dwellings. No matter where you're living, you've got to keep the Sabbath day, whether you're dwelling in the land of Israel or you're scattered across the whole world as we are now. In all your dwellings, you're to keep the Sabbath day, and it's to teach us all of these things that he's saying. You will remember it for this reason. You'll remember it because you were a slave in the land of Egypt. You'll remember it so that you know that I am setting you apart. Mark 2:27, Yeshua speaking, he said to them, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. He's rebuking the Pharisees at the time because they're teaching all of this extra doctrine about how to keep the Sabbath. Yeshua is saying, no, the Sabbath is made for man. It carries the death sentence. It's incredibly important that we do it, but it was made for man. Yahuwah understands how we work, okay? If we're struggling with something in our life, maybe if we just followed the instructions as they were meant to be, they would help in ways that we couldn't appreciate. Yahuwah understands how all of these things work together. Having that day set apart to him, okay? We are refreshed and we are strengthened by his word so that we can then go out and do all the other things. It all works hand in hand. In Nehemiah 10:31, it says, and that if the peoples of the land bring wares or any grain to sell on the Sabbath day, we would not buy it from them on the Sabbath or on a set apart day. And we would forego the seventh year and the interest of every hand. And something that I was talking about with Claire before, about this idea of them setting apart the seventh year as well. They didn't just keep the weekly Sabbath, okay? People, for some reason, seem to have a problem with keeping the Sabbath day, just setting that apart and trusting in the Lord for the provision of that. They would forgo the seventh year, an entire year of not sowing and not harvesting in a society where they would have to have all of their food from growing in the field. They would set apart the entire year and not do that. The interest of every hand, if they've made loans to people, they weren't to collect them in the seventh year. They were to be forgiven. And it's just that dependence on Yahuwah. You've made a loan to somebody. Torah is that you will make a loan to them. The seventh year comes around, you forget that. And you just rely on Yahuwah to pay it back to you because he promises that he will. He says that if you lend to a poor man, he will give it back to you personally. But it's a matter of belief in these things. Nehemiah 13:15-19 says, in those days I saw in Yehuda those treading wine presses on the Sabbath and bringing in sheaves and loading donkeys with wine, grapes and figs and all kinds of burdens which they brought into Jerusalem on the Sabbath day. So I warned them on the day they sold food. And men of Zor dwelling there bringing in fish and all kinds of goods and sold them on the Sabbath to the children of Yehuda and in Jerusalem. Then I contended with the nobles of Yehudah and said to them, what evil matter is this that you are doing, profaning the Sabbath day? So buying, selling on the Sabbath day, this carrying of burdens, as we'll see in Jeremiah in a second, it is profaning the Sabbath day. It's making it a common day. It's not resting from our labor. Did not your fathers do the same, so that our Elohim brought all this evil on us and on this city? This is why they were taken into Babylon. This is why they were captured, because they wouldn't keep the seventh year. They wouldn't keep the Sabbath year. So Yehovah said, okay, you won't keep that year. I'm going to require it of you. I'm going to put you in Babylon for all the Sabbaths that you missed. Yet you did bring added wrath on Israel by profaning the Sabbath day. Okay, so that's really, really important for us to bear in mind. By profaning the Sabbath day, we are bringing wrath upon ourselves. If we've got troubles in our lives, maybe it's because we're being disobedient to Yehovah. And it came to be at the gates of Jerusalem, as it began to be dark before the Sabbath. Interesting, okay? For people who say, well, maybe the Sabbath day starts with the light. No, no, look. As it began to be dark before the Sabbath, okay? Pretty clear when the Sabbath starts. That I commanded the gates to be shut and commanded that they should not be opened till after the Sabbath. I brought up this verse last night on Facebook and somebody said, It was more difficult to do things in the dark then. They had to shut the gates there for the Sabbath the next day. Like they were going to come to the gates of the town and be like, where are the gates? We're not going to be able to shut them. And commanded that they should not be open until after the Sabbath. And I stationed some of my servants at the gates so that no burdens would be brought in on the Sabbath day. So what's it talking about, bringing a burden in on the Sabbath day? See, in Jeremiah 17, 19 to 23, it says, thus Yehovah said to me, go and stand in the gate of the children of the people by which the kings of Yehudah come in and by which they go out, and in all the gates of Jerusalem. And you shall say to them, hear the word of Yehovah. Oh, don't know. Oh, sorry. You kings, should be a space there. You kings of Yehudah and all Yehudah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem who enter by these gates. Okay, this is the word of Yehovah. This is Yehovah speaking here. Thus said Yehovah, guard yourselves and bring no burden on the Sabbath, nor bring it in by the gates of Jerusalem, nor take out a burden out of your houses on the Sabbath day, nor do any work. So this is talking about carrying something that is heavy. This is the reason why the Pharisees didn't want the person carrying their bed. Because they hadn't just stopped at a burden, carrying a burden. They were saying, you can't carry anything on the Sabbath day because it's work, okay? But they did not obey or incline their ear, and they made their neck stiff, not to hear and not to receive instruction. And look where we are now. We're sat somewhere in Britain as opposed to in Israel, surrounded by the blessings of the Lord because these people didn't follow the Sabbath day. Exodus 12:16. This is something else that's important for us to bear in mind. No carrying heavy stuff on the Sabbath day. Exodus 12:16 says, and on the first day is a set-apart gathering, and on the seventh day you have a set-apart gathering. No work at all is to be done on them. Only that which is eaten by every soul, that alone is prepared by you. So this first day, the seventh day that it's talking about here in context, it's talking about unleavened bread. And it's saying, don't do any work on these Sabbath days. The only work that you can do on that day is to cook food only on the first and the seventh day of unleavened bread. So what can we see from that? We're not to do that type of work on the Sabbath day. It is counted as work to prepare food. We see in Exodus 16, 23 to 24, it says, and he said to them, this is what Yehovah has said. Tomorrow is a rest, a Sabbath set apart to Yehovah. That which you bake, bake, and that which you cook, cook, and lay up for yourselves all that is left over to keep it until morning. So you do the cooking the day before, and then you eat it on the Sabbath day. And they laid it up till morning, as Moshe commanded, and it did not stink, and no worm was in it. So if they kept this food previously, it would have rotten. Here, on the Sabbath day, they were to cook, and it was still fine the next day. In Exodus 34:21, it says, 6 days you shall work, but on the seventh day you rest. In plowing time and in harvest you rest. Okay, so plowing and harvesting is work, okay, according to the word of God. But primarily what I get from this verse is, in plowing and in harvest you rest. These were really important times of the year for them. Okay, they really thought, I've got to do work. It's harvest time. I've got loads to do. Didn't matter how important the work was for them to do, they were to rest. So anything that comes up in our lives, we're to rest. We're to just set it aside and say, I'll do that after the Sabbath day. Okay? Anything, no matter how important it is, if you think, oh, I've got to get the harvest in, because if I don't get the harvest in, then it'll all have spoilt, or it won't be the right time to get it in. No, stop on the Sabbath day. Whatever you're doing, you stop on the Sabbath day. There's no excuse ever to break the Sabbath day. Okay, it carries the death penalty. That's how serious it is in Yehovah's eyes. In John 5:10-18, we see this story of Yeshua, where he tells the person to take up his bed and walk. It says, the Yehudim therefore said to him, who had been healed, it is the Sabbath, it is not right for you to take up the bed. So what they did is they added all of this extra stuff on top. When it talks of them loading men down with burdens, it was all of their extra rules. This guy's just carrying his bed around. He answered them, he who made me well said to me, take up your bed and walk. Therefore they asked him, who is the man who said to you, take up your bed and walk? But the one who was healed did not know who it was, for Yeshua had moved away, a crowd being in that place. Afterward, Yeshua found him in the set apart place in the temple and said to him, see, you have been made well. Sin no more, so that no worse matter befalls you. People, when things happen in their lives, they tend to think, this is just a test from the Lord. But it's not according to the word of God. Unless we're Job and we're so righteous. Until we're Job and we're in that position where we're so righteous, we can't say, well, maybe it's a test from the Lord. Maybe he's letting Hasatan come and test me. Because we were talking about it before, it brought out something in Job's heart. And although it took a long time to crush him and get him to the point where he was questioning God, he did end up questioning God. But when we see something in our lives, something that's bad, question, is Yehovah trying to get my attention? Don't try and turn everything. Again, we were talking about it before, weren't we, with a friend of ours who turns everything into a blessing. He's got a very severely disabled son, and he's involved in all kinds of masonry and, you know, all kinds of new age doctrine, and the stuff that he's been involved in his life is not pleasing to the Lord. And he's got a severely disabled son. And it talks in scripture of, you know, the sins of the father being passed on to the next generations. But he refuses to see it as a curse from the Lord. And he always talks about how much of a blessing it is for him to have a disabled son. He always goes on about it. But we need to remember in our lives, when something is going wrong, maybe it's the Lord getting our attention and saying, you're not doing this right. And look to our lives and look to the sin. Because Yeshua says here, he says, go and sin no more, because if you continue sinning, then something worse than that might befall you. The man went away and told the Yehudim that it was Yeshua who made him well. And because of this, the Yehudim persecuted Yeshua and were seeking to kill him because he was doing these healings on the Sabbath. Again, healing on the Sabbath. Torah doesn't say not to heal on the Sabbath. But Yeshua answered them, my father works until now, and I work. If you think that this is work, is not my father in heaven doing these exact same things? This isn't work. Because of this then, the Yehudim were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he also called Elohim his own father, making himself equal with Elohim. Okay, that's what Yeshua was doing. He was making himself equal with Elohim. We've had a discussion recently about whether or not Yeshua is actually Elohim, or whether he was just a man. Okay, Yeshua's own words, he makes himself equal with Elohim. And in their eyes, what they charged him with was breaking the Sabbath. So when we read in the New Testament that Yeshua broke the Sabbath, don't think he's done something in transgression of the Torah. Think, well, the Torah doesn't forbid what Yeshua was doing there. Understand it from that level. Yeshua, in their eyes, He was breaking the Sabbath. He was doing things that were wrong, but they had added a whole lot on top of it. So when you read in the New Testament about Yeshua breaking the Sabbath, take a pause and think, is he actually breaking the Sabbath? Is he breaking the Torah here? Or is he just doing wrong in their eyes? Matthew 24:20-21. Okay, for anyone that thinks that the Sabbath has been done away with, I don't think there's anyone here, but there might be people online. And pray that your flight does not take place in winter or on the Sabbath. In the end times, pray that it's not the Sabbath day when you need to take flight. Why? Why would that be important? For then there shall be great distress, such as not has been since the beginning of the world until this time, no, nor ever shall be. Whatever's going on the Sabbath, keeping the Sabbath is of primary importance. He's saying, look, at this time it's going to be terrible. Pray that it's not on the Sabbath, because if it's on the Sabbath, you're done for, because you're not allowed to do anything. Verse 18 says, and when he had ended speaking with him on Mount Sinai, Yehovah speaking with Moshe, he gave Moshe two tablets of the witness, tablets of stone, written with the finger of Elohim. Okay, so this was the 10 words, okay, that were written on the tablets of stone. Here we get to verse 32. After all of this amazing things happened, they've just come to Mount Sinai. They've just had the covenant laid out for them. Moshe's gone up. He's got these tablets that are written with the finger of God. Then this happens. When the people saw that Moshe delayed in coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aharon and said to him, arise, make us gods who go before us. For this Moshe, the man who's brought us up out of the land of Mitzrayim, we do not know what has become of him. And Aharon said to them, take off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives, your sons, and your daughters, and bring them to me. And all the people took off the gold earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aharon. And he took this from their hand, and he formed it with an engraving tool and made a molded calf. And they said, this is your God, O Yisrael, that's brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim. Bear in mind what Aaron does here, because he's about to say something quite ridiculous when asked what happened. Aaron formed it with an engraving tool and made a molten calf. Okay, and this is the situation that the people were in. Okay, when Moses goes up to the top of the mountain, this is what he says to them before he goes. Yehovah said to Moses, come up to me on the mountain and be there while I give you tablets of stone and the Torah and the command which I have written to teach them. Okay, so they just made this covenant that they'll obey Yehovah. Next thing that Yehovah says is, come up to the top of the mountain and I'll give you the Torah, which is what they're to obey. People like to separate the covenant and the Torah, but it's all one and the same. And Moshe arose with his assistant Yehoshua, and Moshe went up to the mountain of Elohim, and he said to the elders, wait here for us until we come back to you, and see, Aharon and Hur are with you. Whoever has matters, let him go to them. So they were doing this. We see it says, when the people saw that Moshe delayed in coming down from the mountain, okay, that's when they did this. When they saw that he delayed, they saw how long he'd been. Previously, when he'd gone up to the mountain, okay, we see in Exodus 19:3, Moshe went up to Elohim. Exodus 19:20, he goes up again. Exodus 24:1, just before this, he's gone up to Yehovah on the mountain, and he was there for a very short amount of time. I want you to put yourself in the position of the people of Israel. Okay. Previously, when Moses has gone up onto the mountain, this mountain which is burning with fire where Yehovah is, and he said, if anyone comes near the mountain, they are to be put to death. Okay. To their perspective, he's gone up and he's come down in a few days. This time, he was 40 days and 40 nights. Think about that. What you were doing 40 days, 40 nights ago, it's a month and a third. They've been at the base of this mountain, and Moshe had gone up, and they didn't know what had happened to him. Okay. When the people saw that Moshe delayed, okay, this word that's used here for delay, we see it in Strong's here. It does mean delay, can be translated as delay, but see here, to delay in shame. There's something that what Moses was doing was causing the people shame. Okay, I think that that's very interesting, okay, because in the New Testament we read this. We read this about faith, what it is to wait on Yehovah. It says, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace, wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed. It's a weird word for it to use there as well, just as it was with Moses. But they were to have faith that Moses was going up to the top of the mountain and that he was to come down. And sometimes things will happen in our life where we have to wait. We're just told, okay, this is what you're to do at the moment, and we're to wait. We're not to think, not to bring shame to God, not to say that it's a shame for God to have acted in this way. We're not to say, were these people, it was a shame for Moses to act in this way. So we see a very physical living out of what we are to have faith in. Because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts. Okay, sounds lovely, doesn't it? The love of God that's shed abroad in our hearts. Oh, we all feel the love of God. Well, what is the love of God? I looked at this the other week. This is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. That's the love of God. When the love of God is spoken of in Scripture, that's what it is. Okay, and this is something that will build faith as well. When I was talking before about struggling with something, but struggling on the other side of it, okay, that is a tribulation, a trial in our life that builds that faith, that builds that endurance. Okay. Verse 4 says, and he took from this, he took this from their hand, and he formed it with an engraving tool and made the molten calf. And they said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Mitraim. And we kind of read over this and think, oh, okay, molded calf. Is it the God that brought them out of the land of Mitraim? But what had they just heard? Exodus 22-3. I am Yehovah, your Elohim, who brought you out of the land of Mitraim, out of the house of slavery. You have no other gods against my face. They were just told this. They've just agreed to this. It was made very, very clear. They heard this big scary voice from the top of the mountain and they were petrified and they ran away. They ran away. A month later, they're doing exactly what the big scary voice has told them not to do. Interesting, isn't it? People will come to church and they'll feel, oh, I'm so convicted by the word of God. And they'll go off and they'll forget. Exodus 20:23 says, you do not make besides me gods of silver, and you shall not make gods of gold for yourselves. So again, they were just told this right before this sin. Moses now goes up to the top of the mountain. They forget all about this and they just start doing their own thing. What should we do? We've just been told not to make a god for ourselves of gold. Do you reckon we should make it for ourselves a god of gold? And Aharon saw and built an altar before it. And Aharon called out and said, tomorrow is a festival to Yehovah. And they rose early on the next day and offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings. And the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Notice these elements here. This is what they did. Built an altar, rose early in the morning, offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. They ate and drank. We've seen this before. Okay? Again, right before Moses goes up on the mountain, what does Moses do? Opposite, different context than what he's doing here. It says, and Moshe wrote down all the words of Yehovah and rose up early in the morning. And he built an altar at the foot of the mountain and 12 standing columns for the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the children of Israel, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of bulls to Yehovah. Yeah, he did not stretch out his hand against the chiefs of the children of Israel, and they saw Elohim, and they ate and drank. So again, we see here, they're doing it in the right way. We've got all of these elements present here. We're offering, aren't we? We're offering burnt offerings and peace offerings. We've built an altar, and we're making these sacrifices to Yehovah. Again, what are they doing? They're doing it according to their own image. Okay, they're doing it according to the God that they've created in their heads. Jeremiah 2:28 says, But where are the gods that you have made for yourselves? Let them arise and see if they save you in the time of your calamity. Because your gods have become as many as your cities, O Yehudah. We can look at what the children of Israel were doing here, that they'd formed this God that wasn't Yehovah, that they were saying, oh, this is all for Yehovah, sacrifices for Yehovah and stuff. And we can see our own actions in that. People form a God of their own imagination, a God who they are not accountable to, a God who's okay with whatever they do, a God who will forgive them whatever they do. And it's a God that they've created in their own heads. It's a molded calf. That's what people do. And Yehovah says, where are your gods that you have made for yourselves? Let them arise. See if they save you in the time of your calamity. Again, time of our calamity might not come when we're here on the earth. Time of our calamity might be when we're stood before Yehovah, when all of the nonsense which we surrounded ourselves with just falls away. None of it is there. Where are your gods? Let them arise and see if they can save you. Judges 10, 13 to 16 says, but you have forsaken me and served other gods. Again, doesn't matter if we've got an actual idol and we're serving the idol, or whether we've got something that we put above Yehovah. If we know that Yehovah says to do something is wrong and we do it anyway, what we are doing is we are saying that thing is more important to me than Yehovah. Whatever it is, we're saying that it is more important than Yehovah. We can say that we don't worship other gods, but if we've made that thing a god above Yehovah, we're worshiping other gods. You've forsaken me and served other gods. Therefore, I do not save you again. Go and cry out to the gods which you have chosen. Let them save you in your time of distress. Whatever we've chosen, is it going to be anything when we stood before Yehovah? When the judgment comes, it's all just going to fall away. It's all going to be nothing, and we're going to see that we are pitiable and blind and naked, and we will have lived our lives thinking that we were rich and clothed. And then children of Israel said to Yehovah, we have sinned. Do whatever is good in your eyes. Only deliver us today, please. So they put away the foreign gods from their midst and served Yehovah. And his soul was grieved with the trouble of Israel. See, they came to him when they were distressed. They cried out to him in prayer and they said, whatever you want, we'll change our ways. We'll do what's right in your sight. But his soul was still grieved. He honored their repentance and he saved them in that, but he knew what was in their hearts. And we'll see the heart of the children of Israel as we go through this teaching. Deuteronomy 32, 33 to 37 says, their wine is the poison of serpents and the fierce venom of cobras. Okay, wine, the false doctrine. It says poison to them, the venom of cobras. It is not stored up with me, sealed among my treasures. Is it not stored up with me, sealed among my treasures? Vengeance is mine and repayment. At the time their foot slips, for near is the day of their calamity. And the matters prepared are hastening to them. For Yehovah judges his people and has compassion on his servants. When he sees that their power is gone and there is no one remaining, shut up or at large. And he shall say, where are their gods, the rock in whom they sought refuge? Ask yourself, what is the rock that you are seeking refuge in? Are you going after something else? Something that is not Yehovah? Are you building your house on sand? Or are you building yourself on a true rock, a rock that you really can seek refuge in, the word of God, following the word of God, then be the wise man that builds his house on a rock. Jeremiah 11, 11 to 12 says, therefore, thus said Yehovah, see, I am bringing evil on them, which they are unable to escape. What are you going to do? Stood there at the feet of Yehovah. You're not going to be able to escape, are you? You're like, just need the loot. Sorry. Then they shall cry out to me, but I shall not listen to them. And the cities of Yehudah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem shall go and cry out to the gods to whom they burn incense, but they shall bring no deliverance to them at all in the time of their evil. Imagine how ridiculous it would seem to have lived your life and to put store in all of this stuff and then to be stood and all of it stripped away and you've got nothing and you've got no hope. You can't reach out for anything. You just stood there at the feet of God and he's looking at you and you can see that he sees right through you and you can see that he is right when you look at him and you know the sin that you've committed. 1 Kings 12:26 to 33, it says, and Jeroboam, okay, that's Jeroboam, said in his heart, now the rain shall return to the house of David. If these people go up to do sacrifices in the house of Yahuwah at Jerusalem, then the heart of this people shall turn back to their master, Rehoboam, the king of Yehudah. Okay, Rehoboam. And they shall slay me and go back to Rehoboam, the king of Yehudah. So, what's going on here? He's saying in his heart, these are the thoughts of his heart. He's saying, he's letting his fears get the better of him. He's saying, if these people do sacrifices in the house of Yehovah at Jerusalem, then the people, the heart of this people shall turn back to their master, Rehoboam, the king of Yehudah, and they shall slay me and go back to Rehoboam, the king of Yehudah. If we follow the word of God, this bad thing will come about. This comes up in our hearts. We think, if I do this, if I keep the Sabbath day, or if I wear tzitzit, people will think I'm stupid, or whatever the case is, we pre-decide an outcome. We've decided on that outcome, and we fear that outcome, so we do not keep the word of God. It's about trusting in God. And this is where this king went astray. Okay, and look what he does. So the king took counsel, again, counsel not of the word of God, and made 2 calves of gold, and said to the people, it is too much for you to go to Jerusalem. See your gods, O Israel, which brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim. And he set up one in Bethel, and the other he put in Dan. That's where they were. See, the Torah says that they are to go up to here, to go up to Jerusalem. He said, oh no, if they do that, then they'll start to love this other king, and they'll turn against me and they'll kill me. So what he does? 2 places in the territory where he is, where they can go up and offer sacrifices. Again, they're going up and they're doing the same thing. They're offering sacrifices to Yehovah, but it's not in accordance with what he said. He does not pay any heed to the word of Yehovah. He lets his own fear make him create something else that is acceptable in his sight. And he creates these golden calves. Look what he does. And this matter became a sin for the people. For the people went before the one as far as Dan. And he made the house of high places and made priests from all sorts of people who were not the sons of Levi. So again, it's not quite according to the instructions. He's making priests for them to go and offer offerings to Yehovah. Surely that's a good thing. Make priests. Everyone can come and make offerings to Yehovah. But he didn't do it according to the Torah. And Jeroboam performed the festival on the 15th day of the 8th month, like the festival that was in Yehudah. 15th day of the 8th month. A Sukkot is to start on the 15th day of the 7th month. Okay? He was like, oh, we'll just have it on the 8th month. It'll be like the one that they have in Yehudah. And he offered on the altar. So he did at Bethel, sacrificing to the calves that he had made. And at Bethel, he appointed the priests of the high places which he had made. And he made offerings on the altar which he had made at Bethel on the 15th day of the 8th month, in the month that he had devised in his own heart. Okay, not according to the word of God. So what's then? The same now. Okay? We don't do Passover anymore. We're not going to keep Passover. We'll have it on Easter. That's better for everyone, isn't it? Roman Empire, it's got loads of pagans in. If we're going to make them become Christians, then we'll at least keep the days that they want. Otherwise, they'll turn against us and they'll kill us. We'll just have the feast on this day. Okay? We'll Christianize it. All these symbols of fertility, all this paganism, we'll Christianize it. Won't do this anymore. Gosh, it probably doesn't matter. It's only usually a few days apart. It's fine. Great. Let's have the harvest festival at the church. That sounds like a good thing. A festival in the harvest. Let's have a festival in the harvest. Similar. But what it displays is a rejection of the word of Yehovah for the vain imaginations of the heart. Christmas, that's it, that's great. Let's all get together and we'll celebrate the birth of the Savior. That'll be brilliant. Pope will be there waving his golden bell of incense at the baby and be fantastic. Jesus is the reason for the season. No, he's not. Well, he's not. The wickedness in our heart is the reason for the season if we were keeping Christmas. I was thinking that I only kept Christmas when I was a heathen. I was thinking, oh, that's good. But then I thought, oh, no, I didn't. That first Christmas when I went to church, I remember thinking specifically, I'm going to church on Christmas Day. I must really love God. I'm sure that's what people think when they go to church on Christmas Day. They're like, oh, could be at home, it's Christmas. Do our bit, go to church and we'll love God for a bit and then we'll go back and we'll have our Christmas. 1 Kings 18, 20 to 21 says, Ahab then sent for the children of Israel and gathered the prophets on Mount Carmel. And Eliyahu came to all the people and said, how long would you keep hopping between two opinions? If Yehovah is Elohim, follow him. And if Baal, follow him. That's what Christmas is about. It's what Easter is about. It's about the worship of Baal, the worship of the sun god. Stop hopping between two opinions. Don't be double-minded, is what the scriptures call it. James 4, 7 to 8 says, submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Again, we looked at this verse the other week. Question yourself. Have I submitted myself to God? Do I do what God says to do? Holy. Have I submitted myself and I just do what he says? Or am I fooling myself? Am I calling myself one of his people? But I've not yet submitted to him. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Okay? Again, it's not, oh, I'm struggling with this or I'm struggling with that. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. The devil is the tempter. He comes along with a temptation. Once you resist him, he will flee from you. I've experienced this myself, experiencing temptation and then denying it, quoting the word of God, then the tempter flees. And it is a real tangible thing, that temptation that is brought by the spiritual entity, the tempter. He brings the temptation to you and you feel the temptation is really, really strong. You really want to do whatever it is. Resist that, the tempter flees, and then it's like, don't know what the big deal was. That was quite easy. That was easy to resist. Draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and cleanse your hearts, ye double-minded. People who are of two opinions. They follow Torah, but they also, I'm not quite sure about this, and I'm not quite sure about that. It's being double-minded in Yehovah's sight. Psalm 119, 112 to 113 says, I have inclined my heart to do your laws forever to the end. I hate the double-minded, but I have loved your Torah. The Torah, that which is pure. You try and mix other things in with it. You try to do a little bit of Torah and, you know, I'll do Torah on a Saturday and I'll think about it sometimes during the week. It's being double-minded. Submit yourselves to God. Submission. Think about what it is to submit, to completely give yourself over to it. That's what submission to God is. That is what repentance is. Isaiah 5, 20 to 24 says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil and put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Okay, we've looked at this before. Okay, those who call the Torah evil. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and clever in their own sight. How many people do you know that have got false doctrine that explains away why you're not to wear tzitzit anymore, or you're not to do this or that? Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and clever in their own sight, who lean on their own understanding and not on the understanding that comes from the word of God. Woe to the mighty to drink and brave men to mix strong drink. Again, talking about this false doctrine. Those who are clever in their own eyes, who've drunk of this false doctrine and are drunk on it, who declare right the wrong for a bribe, and the righteousness of the righteous, they turn aside from him. Therefore, as a tongue of fire devours the stubble and the flame consumes the chaff, their root is rottenness. Okay, it comes from the evilness of their hearts. They will prefer this. They prefer the false doctrine. They would prefer to call those elements of the Torah evil. They prefer to be wise in their own eyes, to lean on their own understandings. And it's because their root is rottenness and their blossom goes up like dust, because they have rejected the Torah of Yehovah Sevaot and despised the word of the set apart one of Yisrael. That's what they're doing in following this false doctrine, which is not what the scriptures teach. They've rejected the Torah. Because they've come to the Torah and they've said, no, we're not to do that anymore. We'll do this or we'll do that, or, you know, this bit doesn't apply or that bit doesn't apply. And rejected the Torah. And in doing so, they've despised the word of the Holy One of Israel. Serious. To be stood in front of Yehovah and for him to say, you've despised my word. You've rejected my word. When you heard it being spoken, you rejected it and you went your own way. Verse 7 says, and Yehovah said to Moshe, go get down, for your people, whom you brought out of the land of Mitzrayim, have corrupted themselves. Interesting phraseology that he uses here. Your people, Moses. Your people, not my people. No more is there, and I shall dwell in the midst of the children of Israel and shall be their Elohim. They shall know that I am Yehovah, their Elohim. I will be their Elohim and they will be my people. That's how he was speaking to them. That's the promise that he made to them, that he would be there. Now, Moses, your people, distancing language that's being used. Yehovah, his wrath is rising at this point. It says, they have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf and have bowed themselves to it and sacrificed to it and said, this is your God, O Israel, who brought you out of the land of Mitzrayim. And Yehovah said to Moshe, I have seen this people. And see, it is a stiff-necked people. And now let me alone that my wrath might burn against them and I consume them and I make of you a great nation. So what he's saying is, get out of the way, I'll destroy them and I'll make a nation of you. Now I've heard rabbinical teachings on this before, and the rabbis, they like, when people say something about against God, against a proclamation of God, they like to uphold that and say, oh no, look, this man has argued against God and his wisdom prevailed. Because Moshe intercedes against these people, or for these people now. And they love to look at things like that and say, well, this man was more righteous than God. God had said he was going to destroy all the people, but Moses rose up and he interceded against them, and, you know, isn't Moses great? Okay, that's the typical rabbinical teaching that you'll get on this. But what I've been considering this week, maybe Yehovah was right when he said, these people are a stiff-necked people. Get out of the way, I'll destroy them and I'll start again with you. We see all the way through the Torah, he says, remove the evil one from your midst. So Yehovah says, I'll destroy them, I'll start again with you. What is the result of Moses' intercession here of them going into the land? He's declared they are a stiff-necked people. Judges 2:18-19, it says, and when Yehovah raised up rulers for them, Yehovah was with the ruler and saved them from the hand of their enemies all the days of the ruler. For Yehovah had compassion on their groaning because of those who oppressed them and crushed them. So after the time of Joshua, there was the time of the judges. The people would fall away from following Yehovah. He'd raise up a ruler and they'd get all zealous to follow Yahuwah again, and things would start going well for them. Then the ruler would die and they'd be like, oh, the ruler's not there anymore. We've got nothing in ourselves that makes us want to do it. And it came to be when the ruler was dead that they would turn back and do more corruptly than their fathers, to go after other gods, to serve them and bow down to them. They did not refrain from their practices and from their stubborn way. Same word here, stiff-necked, stubborn. Okay, it's translated two different ways. In Ezekiel 2:3-5, so after the time of the judges, after the time of the kings, okay, after Israel has been scattered throughout the nations, just before Yehudah gets taken to Babylon. And he said to me, son of man, I am sending you to the children of Israel, to a nation of rebels who have rebelled against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me until this day, and the children are stiff of face and hard of heart to whom I am sending you. And you shall say to them, thus said Adonai Yehovah. And they, whether they hear or whether they refuse, for they are a rebellious house, shall know that a prophet has been in their midst. Whether people listen to the word of God, whether they refuse to hear the word of God, they will know one day that a prophet has spoken to them, that the word of God has been spoken to them. Again, may come too late for some people. It might come when they're actually stood before Yehovah. But they will know the word of God. He will pour out his spirit and make his word known to them. Deuteronomy 10:16 says, and you shall circumcise the foreskin of your heart and harden your neck no more, to be stiff-necked. Now people think that having your heart circumcised is a replacement for being circumcised in the flesh. It's not the case. Look, this is in Deuteronomy 10. He's saying to them, circumcise your heart so that you will submit to me. It's this submission to God. Acts 7:51. Again, these are the people who are living in the land of Israel that Stephen's speaking to at this point. It says, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit as your fathers did, you also do. So these people who ended up going into the land after Moses' intercession, they were a stiff-necked people. If Yehovah had just started again with Moshe, maybe things would have been different. Leads to this. Okay, in Hebrews 8:7-10, it says, for if that first covenant had been faultless, then no place would have been sought for a second. For finding fault with them, he says, see, the days are coming, says Yehovah, when I shall make with the house of Israel and with the house of Yehudah a new covenant, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day when I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Mitzrayim, because they did not continue in my covenant and I disregarded them, says Yehovah. Because this is the covenant that I shall make with the house of Israel after those days, says Yehovah, giving my laws in their mind, and I shall write them on their hearts, and I shall be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. So it had to come to this, where he was like, that covenant that I had with their fathers, okay, I disregarded their fathers, I did not pay attention to them. You who want to follow my Torah, you can come back and be in this new covenant. That was the whole purpose of this, the circumcision of the heart. It took all of this time, all the people in the land to be scattered out of the land, to be taken into Babylon, back into the land, then to be finally scattered out of the land, all to bring us to a situation where we're sitting in a little church in Bevington, and we've all actually now got the desire to follow after Yehovah. We've all circumcised our hearts. Take a break. Okay, so the first part and the second part were perhaps a little bit intense. But it's something that we need to reflect on from the position that we're in. That's all scary stuff if you're in the position of stiff-necked, stubborn, hard-hearted. But the position that we're in, we've embraced the word of God, and we live our lives by the word of God. And if we do that, the promises that are given to us are absolutely phenomenal. Just reading through the Revelation 21 and 22, reading what it will be like in the kingdom, they're the promises that are given to us, but we need to be diligent. Okay, we have the heart to follow the Torah, but the tempter will come and he will give lies, reasons why it's okay to not follow the Torah. So this is why it's important for us to focus on things like this and say, I'm not having any of it. I'm not listening to any of the lies. I'm going to resist you. You can go away. I've submitted myself to God. Now verse 11 says, but Moshe pleaded with Yehovah his Elohim and said, Yehovah, why does your wrath burn against your people whom you have brought out of the land of Mitzrayim with great power and with a strong hand? And he's not saying to him, what's the problem? All they're doing is they've made the golden calf and they're having a bit of a dance and a bit of a sing. Why are you so angry? That's not what this why means. It's two different whys in the Hebrew. Why can be an inquiry as to the cause of something. Like, why are you so angry? What's the cause of you being so angry? Or why can be an inquiry about what the outcome is to be. What's the outcome of this? Why are you getting so angry? Where is this leading? Okay. Whom you have brought out of the land of Mitzrayim with great power and with a strong hand. And Yehovah said to Moshe, go get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Mitzrayim have corrupted themselves. Now, we've heard this language that's used here before, this idea of the people having corrupted themselves. Okay, Yehovah wants to come and wipe out all of the people because they've corrupted themselves. Remind you of anything? Any other stories? Noah, exactly. Genesis 6:12. And Elohim looked upon the earth and saw that it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. Okay, so just like with Noah, he's saying to Moses, I'm going to wipe out all these people and start again with just you. Moses intercedes. Why should the Mitzrites speak and say, for evil he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from the heat of your wrath and relent from this evil to your people. Remember Abraham, Yitzchak, and Yisrael, your servants to whom you swore by yourself and said to them, I increase your seed like the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of, I give to your seed, and they shall inherit it forever. And Yehovah relented from the evil which he said he would do to his people. And as I said this week, I've been considering whether when Yehovah said, I will destroy all of this people, just like he did with Noah, and he said, I'll start again, and he got rid of all the evil from the earth at that point, whether his destruction of all of those people would have been the just thing for him to do. I'm not saying that it is. What I've said, though, again, I disagree with the rabbinical teachings that teach, oh no, when Moses came up and he was arguing with God, Moses had the better way of doing it. God was going to destroy everyone. What a horrible, nasty God. Isn't it great that we've got Moses to come along and argue our case for us? Okay, not a way that we should see Yahweh. Genesis 6:5-6, it uses these two words, evil and sorry. Just like it says here, evil. And when it says that he relented from the evil which he said that he would do to his people, it's the same word in the Hebrew. Again, we see this whole thing with the words being used. They're used in one place. And when they're all used in a cluster together, and they're all used in the cluster together in another place, we know that those two stories are telling us something about the other one. Yehovah saw the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every inclination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And Yehovah was sorry that he made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. Okay, and what do we have happening in the story of Moses, the story of Noah? An opportunity to wipe out all of the evil and start again with just that one person. Noah went with it. He did what the Lord said, and he just trusted in the Lord. Moses says, oh no, please have mercy upon your people. Verse 15 says, and Moshe turned and went down from the mountain, and in his hand were the two tablets of the witness, tablets written on both their sides, written on the one and on the other. And the tablets were the work of Elohim, and the writing was the writing of Elohim engraved on the tablets. And Yehoshua heard the noise of the people as they shouted, and he said to Moshe, a noise of battle in the camp. And he said, it is not the sound of those who shout of might, nor is it the sound of those who cry out in weakness, but of the sound of singing that I hear. And it came to be, as soon as he came near the camp, that he saw the calf and the dancing, and Moshe's displeasure burned, and he threw the tablets out of his hands and broke them at the foot of the mountain. And we've got a great picture there. We know that Moses goes back up the mountain, and then he gets the Ten Commandments, and they're written again. This time he comes down, and the people are all sinful, and he takes the word of God, and he breaks it. So we've got a picture there of Yeshua, who came down to sinful man, and he was broken, and he's gone back up, and he will come down again, the word of God. Verse 20 says, and he took the calf which they have made, and burned it in the fire, and ground it into powder, and scattered it on the face of the water, and made the children of Israel drink it. We get more detail on exactly that process. It says, Moses saying, "And I took your sin, the calf which you have made, and burned it with fire, and crushed it, and ground it very small, until it was fine as dust." This is an important element. "And I threw it, its dust, into the stream that came down from the mountain." Okay? The elements that he does here. He burned it with fire. Okay, he wasn't just scorching it. This is a process of him melting the gold. Okay? Crushed it. Ground it very small until it was fine as dust. Then he puts the dust in the water that's coming down off the mountain. Why is he doing this? Seems like a bit of a bizarre process. You get the calf, you know, melt it down and then crush it, stamp on it, then grind it up fine as dust and then throw it into the water. Okay? He makes the people drink it. So what's he doing here? "And he took the calf which they had made and burnt it in the fire and ground it into powder and scattered it on the face of the water." And then what does he do? He makes the children of Israel drink this gold that's been melted, crushed flat, ground up into dust, and then put in the water, and they drink this. In chemistry, I'm not sure that they'd be ill, I'm not really sure. In chemistry, we've got three different ways that you can mix substances. We've got a solution, that's where you take something and you mix it into a solvent and it chemically changes and becomes something different. So it's a solution at that point, it's chemically different. We can have a suspension, which is where particles of something are mixed in something else. And it doesn't chemically change, it doesn't become a new substance, it's still both of the original substances. They're separate from each other. Or you can have it where you just put the thing in and it doesn't dissolve at all. What Moses did is he created the suspension, but he created a very particular type of suspension, okay? In making the gold ductile, in crushing it flat and then crushing it up fine, he made it colloidal. And then he puts it into the water. He makes colloidal gold at this point. What that would have resulted in is the production of colloidal gold. There's the steps that we've just read. And colloidal gold, okay, it would have purified the people. They were in their sin, and the colloidal gold would have purified them. But the colloidal gold is red in color. Okay, so we've got... we've got them having this colloidal gold, which is red, it looks like blood, and then being purified of their sin by it. So we've got an absolutely amazing picture of the Messiah again in the Torah. Moses did indeed write of Yeshua. Verse 21 says, "And Moses said to Aharon, what did this people do to you that you have brought so great a sin upon them?" This is absolute classic now that Aaron pulls out. He says, "And Aharon said, do not let the displeasure of my master burn. You know the people, that it is in evil. And they said to me, make us God to go before us. For this Moshe, the man who brought us out of the land of Mitzrayim, we do not know what has become of him. And I said to them, whoever has gold, let them take it off. And they gave it to me. And I threw it into the fire. And this calf came out." Not the most believable thing that he could have come up with in the circumstance. Of course, we know from the Torah that it's not true. "And Moses saw that the people were let loose, for Aharon had let them loose to their shame among their enemies. And Moses stood in the entrance of the camp and said, who is for Yahuwah? Come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves to him. And he said to them, thus said Yahuwah Elohim of Israel, each one put his sword on his side, pass over to and fro from the gate in the camp, and each one slay his brother, and each one his friend, and each one his relative." Now, I've heard people try to kind of, Disney-fy this. They kind of make it a bit more palatable in the eyes of people, and they've said, this was just Moses telling them to go out and kill all the people. The fact that he says that Yahuwah said it. He didn't really say it. It's just something that Moses said to get them to do it. Not the case, okay? Yahuwah doesn't then call Moses back up to the top of the mountain and go, what are you doing? You just told them that I've said to kill 3,000 of them. Not the case. Yahuwah actually commanded this. He saw the evil that the people were doing. Moshe went down and Yahweh commanded him to gather of the people to kill their brothers. And the sons of Levi did according to the word of Moshe, and about 3,000 men of the day fell that day. Why is it about 3,000? Okay, what did we just read about when the census is taken, when you count the children of Israel? Now, it said when they were doing this, they said tomorrow is a festival to Yahuwah. Okay, we looked at the festivals of Yahuwah. They are on specific dates. Okay, they're his Moedim. So what is this festival that they're talking about? Well, Passover's just happened, so it's not the festival of unleavened bread. What's the very next one? We looked. It's Shavuot, okay, or Pentecost as it's known. So they're saying tomorrow is a festival to Yahuwah, and this is when Moshe comes down with the tablets from the mountain. This is when the law is given. Also, when the Spirit is given. It says in Acts 2:37-41, and having heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Kepha and the rest of the apostles, "Men, brothers, what shall we do?" And Kepha said to them, "Repent and let each of you be immersed in the name of Yeshua Messiah for the forgiveness of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. Repent and be baptized. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as Yahuwah or Elohim shall call." It tells us earlier in Acts 2 that he was actually speaking to the house of Israel, specifically tells us that those who are afar off, when the scriptures use that phrase, it's talking about the house of Israel who are cast afar off. And he says, "I will make you my people again and I will be your Elohim." And with many other words, he earnestly witnessed and urged them, saying, "Be saved from this crooked generation." Then those indeed who gladly received his word were immersed. And on that day, okay, Shavuot again, about 3,000 souls were added to them. So Shavuot in the past, about 3,000 souls were killed. Shavuot in the future, when people repent, turn back to him, when they've circumcised their hearts and they're baptized, about 3,000 were added to Israel. Verse 29 says, "And Moshe said, 'You are ordained for Yahuwah today.'" Now this isn't when they became the Levitical priests. That Yahuwah hadn't even said, "Okay, take the children of Levi, they will be the priests." When it says ordained, what it's talking about, the word means essentially like plereu. It means to fulfill. It means to fill up. You have set yourselves apart to be fully committed to Yahuwah this day in this action that you've taken against your brothers who are in sin. You have fully filled yourselves up. "Since each one has been against his son and his brother, so as to bring upon you a blessing this day." Okay, the same blessing that comes from any kind of obedience comes from filling ourselves up with Yahuwah. "And it came to be on the next day that Moshe said to the people, 'You have sinned a great sin, and now I am going up to Yahuwah if I might atone for your sin.'" So you'll notice when he's on the mountain the first time, okay, he doesn't say, "I make atonement for the children of Israel," because they were still in the sin. They were still sinning at that point. So he can't ask for forgiveness for them at that point. He had to come down from the mountain, stop them from doing what they were doing, and then go back up and then ask for forgiveness. It gives us a powerful picture. Okay, we can't ask for forgiveness from God until we've repented of our sin. Only at that point can atonement then be made for our sins. "And Moshe returned to Yahuwah and said, 'Oh, these people have sinned a great sin and have made for themselves a god of gold. And now, if you would forgive their sin, but if not, please blot me out of the book which you have written.' Yahuwah said to Moshe, 'Whoever has sinned against me, I blot him out of my book. And now go lead the people to the place of which I've spoken to you. See, my messenger goes before you, and in the day of my visitation, I shall visit their sin upon them.' And Yahuwah plagued the people because they made the calf which Aaron made. And Yahuwah said to Moshe, 'Come, go up from here, you and the people whom you have brought out of the land of Mitzrayim to the land of which I swore to Abraham, to Yitzchak, and to Yaakov, saying, to your seed I shall give it. And I shall send my angel before you, and I shall drive out the Canaanite and the Amorite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite to a land flowing with milk and honey. For I do not go up in your midst, because you are a stiff-necked people, lest I consume you on the way. It's like, I know what these people are like. I'm not going to go up in their midst, because they'd be stiff-necked, they'd be rebellious against me, and I would destroy them, because they would be in my holy presence in their unclean state, in their spiritual state of uncleanness. Cannot go up amongst these people. And when the people heard this evil word, they mourned, and no one put on his ornaments, the jewelry that he had that the Egyptians gave them when they came out of Egypt. And Yehovah said to Moshe, say to the children of Israel, you are a stiff-necked people. Should I go up in your midst for one moment, I shall consume you. And now take off your ornaments, and I shall know what to do to you. So the children of Israel took off their ornaments at Mount Horeb. Okay? Symbolic. They're taking off the blessings which had been bestowed on them when they were freed from Egypt. They were taking it off now at Mount Sinai. You see, when they first came to Mount Sinai, everything was great. We'll make a covenant with these people. Okay? Here, they've broken the covenant. They've been stiff-necked. They've been rebellious. Now, they take off the blessings that they've been given. And Moshe took his tent and pitched it outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the tent of meeting. And it came to be that everyone who sought Yehovah went out to the tent of meeting, which was outside the camp. Okay, this is the tent of meeting before the tabernacle is built. He's been given the instructions to build the tabernacle, but they've not actually built it at this point. And it came to be whenever Moshe went out to the tent that all the people rose and each man stood at the door of his tent and watched Moshe until he entered the tent. And it came to be when Moshe entered the tent that the column of cloud descended and stood at the door of the tent, and he spoke with Moshe. And all the people saw the column of cloud standing at the tent door. And all the people rose and bowed themselves, each one at the door of his tent. Thus Yehovah spoke to Moshe face to face as a man speaks to his friend. Now this is an idiom. Okay, he didn't come and be in human form and speak to him so that he saw the face of God. We're told that nobody sees the face of God and lives. Okay? What this is talking about when it says face to face, it's talking about knowing someone in an intimate way. This is how he spoke with Moshe, as a friend, okay? And we see this throughout Scripture. We actually have revealed to us in Scripture how we can be in this same position, how we can be friends of Elohim. Psalm 25:14 says, the friendship of Yehovah is for those who fear him. Okay, the fear of Yehovah leads to wisdom. The fear of Yehovah leads to knowledge, all of his word. And he makes known to them his covenant. The ones that fear him, they are the friends of Yehovah. John 15:13-15 says, no one has greater love than this, that one should lay down his life for his friends. So he's saying here, I will lay down my life for my friends. Do you want to be my friends? Okay, I'll tell you how to be my friends. You are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. If you don't do that, then you're not his friends, and he hasn't laid down his life for you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. We know what Yehovah is doing because we follow his word. It tells us what he's doing. Yeshua said, didn't he? I do what I see my father doing. Same with us. But I have called you friends, for all teachings which I've heard from my father, I have made known to you. Okay? He taught the Torah. He taught the words of Moses. If you would believe Moses, you would have believed my words. How can you believe my words if you didn't believe Moses? Matthew 23:1-3. Okay, if we got here, you are my friends if you do whatever I command you. What had he just commanded them to do? Then Yeshua spoke to the crowds and to his disciples, saying, the scribes and the Pharisees sit on the seat of Moshe. Therefore, whatever they say to you to observe, observe and do. You're my friends if you observe and do whatever Moshe says. Whatever the scribes and the Pharisees teach from Moses' seat, which is the Torah. If you do that, then you're my friends, and I have laid down my life for you. Verse 12 says, and Moshe said to Yehovah, see, you are saying to me, bring up this people, but you have not made known to me whom you would send with me. Though you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found grace in my eyes. Okay, whole thing. Oh no, grace is a New Testament thing. Moses, the truth came through Moses, but grace and truth came through Yeshua. It's a New Testament thing. There was no grace in the Old Testament. It was all law. We find grace in his eyes in the same way that Moses found grace in his eyes. You think that Moses never sinned? You know, Moses lived a sinless life. Okay? He found grace in the eyes of Yehovah because he repented of the evil that he'd done. Moses killed somebody in his life before he left Egypt. He killed somebody. But he's found grace in the eyes of Yehovah because he's repented of that. Yeah, the one that was abusing the other Hebrews. And now please, if I have found grace in your eyes, please show me your way and let me know you so that I may find grace in your eyes. It reminds me of the prayer that you pray, that God would show you the way that he wants you to live. Yeah. Very similar to what Moses says here. And consider that this nation is your people. And he said, my presence does go and I shall give you rest. And he said to him, if your presence is not going, do not lead us up from here. For how then shall it be known that I have found grace in your eyes, I and your people, except you go with us? Then we shall be distinguished and your people from all the earth who are upon the face of the earth. And Yehovah said to Moshe, even this word you have spoken, I shall do for you, for you have found grace in my eyes and I know you by name. So he said, I'm not going to go up in your midst, lest I destroy you. Moses says, if you're not going to go with us, forget it. He says, okay, even this word that you've spoken to me, I'll do this because you, Moses, because you have found grace in my eyes. Then he said, please show me your glory. And he said, I shall cause all my goodness to pass before you, and I shall proclaim the name of Yehovah before you. And I shall be gracious on him with whom I will be gracious and shall have compassion on him whom I will have compassion. We know who those people are, the people who turn to him. But he said, you are unable to see my face, for no man does see me and live. You see, it's not contradicting itself when it says he sees him face to face or he speaks to him face to face. No man shall see his face. Face to face is just an idiom for intimately. And Yehovah said, see, there is a place with me, and you shall stand on the rock, and it shall be while my glory passes by that I shall put you in the cleft of the rock and cover you with my hand while I pass by. When I was looking for a picture for the background for this, went with this one. But I haven't done a search before that has yielded such amazing results. Okay, these are people's artistic impressions of Moses in the cleft of the rock. Okay, you get the... then he says, then you shall take away my hand and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. Okay, so you get the more abstract ones, and it's a bit weird. It seems to have invoked this kind of real artistic streak in people to go out and do this. You don't usually get this when you're looking for stuff throughout the Bible. And you get the bizarre ones. You get the more ridiculous ones. Doesn't really reflect what he said when he said, I'll put you in the cleft of the rock and I'll put my hand over you and stuff. Okay. This, I imagine that you probably sell stuff like this in the art gallery. Maybe. is it not kind of biblically based? Right, okay. It's not the style, but it's the kind of the what it would be about. This one is my favorite one, though. This is brilliant that somebody took the time to do this one. I thought I could just put that one as the background. Everyone might be a bit confused. Okay, chapter 34 says, and Yehovah said to Moshe, cut two tablets of stone like the first ones, and I shall write on these tablets the words that were on the first tablets which you broke. And be ready in the morning, then you shall come up in the morning to Mount Sinai and present yourself to me there on the top of the mountain, very reminiscent of when the 144,000 are presented to the Lord on Mount Zion. And let no man come up with you, and let no man be seen in all the mountain, and let not even the flock or the herd feed in front of that mountain, very reminiscent of the first time when the covenant was made. And he cut two tablets of stone like the first ones. Then Moshe rose early in the morning and went up Mount Sinai as Yahuwah had commanded him. And he took two tablets of stone in his hand. This must have been ridiculously knackering. He's always up and down the mountain. Now he's got two tablets of stone with him. Come up the mountain again, this time. Bring two giant tablets of stone. Exodus 20:4-7, it says, "You do not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of that which is in the heavens above or which is in the earth beneath or that which is in the waters underneath the earth. You do not bow down to them nor serve them, for I, Yehovah, your Elohim, am a jealous ale, visiting the iniquities of the fathers on the children to the third and fourth generations of those who hate me, but showing kindness to thousands to those who love me and uphold my commands. You do not carry the name of Yahuwah your Elohim in vain, for Yahuwah does not leave the one unpunished who carries his name in vain." Notice the tenor of how he's speaking now. He's saying, I'm a serious God, not to be messed around with. And the real focus of this is, look, I'm going to visit the iniquities of the fathers. I'm going to show kindness to thousands who love me and keep my commands. It's all keep my commands and I'll show kindness to them. Otherwise, it's really not going to be good for them. In Exodus 23:20-24, it says, "See, I am sending a messenger before you to guard you in the way and to bring you into the place which I have prepared. Be on your guard before him and obey his voice. Do not rebel against him, for he is not going to pardon your transgression, for my name is in him. But if you diligently obey his voice and shall do all that I speak, then I shall be an enemy to your enemies and a distresser to those who distress you. For my messenger shall go up before you and shall bring you into the land of the Amorites and the Hittites and the Perizzites and the Canaanites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, and I shall cut them off." Okay, again, notice the tenor of what is being said here, the focus of what's being said. He's revealing part of his name to the people here. In verse 7, okay, we see the sin that we've just seen. He said, "They've turned quickly aside out of the way that I commanded them." He said, "My wrath is going to burn against these people." Okay, all very much the same. Then in verse 19, he says, and he said, "I shall cause all my goodness to pass before you." This is when he says, "I will proclaim the name of Yehovah." Here we see something else about the name of Yehovah, his name being his character. When he says, "I will go before you and I will proclaim the name," this is what he says. "I shall proclaim the name of Yehovah before you, and I shall be gracious on him whom I will be gracious, and shall have compassion on him whom I will have compassion." And Yehovah came down in the cloud and stood with him there and proclaimed the name Yehovah. And Yehovah passed before him and proclaimed, "Yehovah, Yehovah, an El, compassionate and showing grace, patient and great in kindness and truth, watching over kindness for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, but by no means leaving unpunished, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and the children's children to the third and fourth generation." He's saying the same thing, but the focus has shifted slightly. Instead of him focusing on, if they disobey me, it's going to be terrible. Okay? He says, "I am compassionate. I will forgive transgression." He frames it. He says, if they obey me, if they keep my commandments, I will show compassion on them. I will have mercy on them. It's the same message, but it's said in a very slightly different way. The first time was with the first covenant that he was making with them. And Moshe hurried and bowed himself toward the earth and did obeisance and said, "If now I have found favor in your eyes, O Yehovah, I pray, let Yehovah go on in our midst, even though we are a stiff-necked people, and forgive our iniquity and our sin, and take us as your inheritance." And he said, "See, I am making a covenant." Okay, so we've got a picture there of the first covenant being made and being broken, and then a new covenant being made with the people and through that forgiveness coming. Are you saying in this covenant, you've got to come back to me, you've got to obey my voice? Of course, we know that they don't, and that caused the need for the new covenant, which we are a part of. But it's just a picture. Before all your people, I'm going to do wonders such as not have been done in the earth, in all the earth, nor in any nation, and all the people among whom you are shall see the work of Yahuwah, for what I am doing with you is awesome. Uphold what I command you today. See, I am driving out from before you the Amorite and the Canaanite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Hivite and the Jebusite. Guard yourself lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land where you are going, lest it be a snare in your midst. But break down their altars, smash their pillars, and cut down their Asherim. For you do not bow yourself to another god, for Yahuwah, whose name is jealous, is a jealous ale. It's not saying, when you're referring to Yahuwah, call him jealous, that's his name. It's saying his name, his character is jealous. It also means zealous. He is very zealous for his Torah. We've seen that in the things that he says. Do it in this particular way. If you don't do it in this particular way, I'm going to be angry because I am zealous for my word. Lest you make a covenant with the inhabitants of the land and they whore after their gods and sacrifice to their gods, and one of them invites you and you eat of his sacrifices, and you take of his daughters for your sons, and his daughters whore after their gods, and make your sons whore after their gods. Exactly what happened with Solomon. Do not make a molded god for yourselves. Know what you like. Just told you this before. Verse 18 says, uphold the festival of unleavened bread. For 7 days you eat unleavened bread as I commanded you in the appointed time of the month of Aviv. Because in the month of Aviv, you came out from the land of Mitzrayim. So the festival of unleavened bread during that time, okay, at the beginning of it, the Passover meal is eaten on the beginning of the first day. Then, whenever the Sabbath is, the next day, that's the Feast of First Fruits. But it's all collectively known as the Festival of Unleavened Bread, which is why you will see in the New Testament, sometimes it refers to the actual Passover as unleavened bread. It's because it's one and the same. Everyone opening the womb is mine, and every male firstborn among your livestock, whether bull or sheep. But the firstborn of a donkey you shall ransom with a lamb. And if you do not ransom, then you shall break his neck. Every firstborn of your sons you shall ransom, and they shall not appear before me empty-handed. So he reiterates the seriousness of keeping this. If you don't follow what I've commanded you to do, then you are to kill the animal itself. Okay, what would you rather do? Would you rather ransom it with a lamb? Or would you rather just get rid of it, not have it at all? 6 days you work, but on the seventh day you rest. In plowing time and in harvest you rest. Okay, again, the verse that we read before. Whether you're plowing, whether you're harvesting, or whether you're doing whatever is so important in your life, you rest on the Sabbath day. And perform the festival of weeks for yourself, that's Shavuot, of the first fruits of the wheat harvest, and the festival of ingathering, Sukkot, at the end of the year, turn of the year. 3 times in the year, all your men are to appear before the Lord Yahuwah, the Elohim of Yisrael. For I dispossess nations before you and shall enlarge your borders, and let no one covet your land when you go up to appear before Yahuwah. Okay, again, it's this faith that keeping Yahuwah's commandments is going to lead to what is good. It's not turning and going, but if we do that, it will be terrible. If we leave the land and we go up to Jerusalem, then people will come and they'll steal the land. Yahuwah says, no, I will protect the land. Okay, you just concern yourself with doing what my commandments say to do, and I'll sort out the rest for you. Do not offer the blood of my sacrifice with leaven, and do not let the sacrifice of the festival of the Passover remain until morning. Bring the first fruits of your land to the house of Yahuwah your Elohim. Do not cook a young goat in its mother's milk. Jews will have it that this means don't eat meat and milk together. Doesn't mean what it says. Okay. Yahuwah said to Moshe, write these words. In accordance with these words have I made a covenant with you and with Israel. The whole doctrine of, oh, the covenant that they made at Sinai, that was the covenant, that was the book of the covenant, that's all that we have to keep. The law which came after it, we don't have to keep it. Now, this is another covenant that's made, and he's just given a short, abbreviated version, because he's going to give them the Torah next. And he was there with Yehovah 40 days and 40 nights. He did not eat bread, and he did not drink water, and he wrote on the tablets the words of the covenant, the 10 words. You think he had the dry throat? And it came to be when Moshe came down from Mount Sinai, while the two tablets of the witness were in Moshe's hand, when he came down from the mountain, that Moshe did not know that the skin of his face shone since he had spoken with him. And Aharon and all the children of Israel looked at Moshe and saw the skin on his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. And Moshe called out to them, and Aharon and all the rulers of the congregation returned to him. And Moshe spoke to them. And afterward, all the children of Israel came near. And he commanded them all that Yehovah had spoken with him on Mount Sinai. And when Moshe ended speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. But whenever Moshe went in before Yehovah to speak with him, he would remove the veil until he came out. And when he came out, he spoke to the children of Israel what he had been commanded. And the children of Israel would see the face of Moshe, that the skin of Moshe's face shone. And Moshe would put the veil on his face again, and he went in to speak with him. Now, the passage that we're going to end on is on the next slide, but this is so important because this is misunderstood. Okay, people will tell you another meaning to this passage. Okay, and it's to do with Moshe's face shining. Okay, we looked at this the other week, but it's very worth going through again to see exactly what the Torah is. Because when you read something like this, it can be confusing if you just read it out of context. 2 Corinthians 3:6-9 says, "Who also made us competent servants of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life." Okay, so people will read this and they'll say, well, if we're following the law to the letter, it's just going to kill us. But the Spirit's obviously different to following the law to the letter. The Spirit gives life, we'll just walk by the Spirit. It'll be brilliant. But if the administering of death in letters engraved on stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel were unable to look steadily at the face of Moses because of the glory of his face, which was passing away, how much more glorious shall the administering of the Spirit not be? Okay, the law written on stones. People tend to think that this was the Ten Commandments. Okay, the law written on stones wasn't the Ten Commandments. Ten Commandments were written on stone, but that's not what Paul's referring to here. He's referring to what we've read in Ezekiel before. The heart of stone. That's what Yehovah takes out of our flesh and gives us a heart of flesh. And on the heart of flesh, the law can be written by the Spirit. So, if the law was so glorious that when he came down to the stiff-necked people that would not listen to it, they had hearts of stone. When they beheld his face, it shone. It was so glorious. And that law could only bring death to those people. How much more glorious shall the administering of the Spirit be when the law is written on our hearts and we follow it? For if the administering of condemnation had glory, okay, it's not saying that the law is the ministry of condemnation. It's saying that the law written on stony hearts is a ministry of condemnation. That's all it can bring. The administering of righteousness exceeds much more in glory. Maybe we'll all have shiny faces in the kingdom. Should we pray? Father, I thank you for the heart of flesh that you've given us. I thank you for your Spirit that you've given to us to write your holy, perfect Torah on our hearts. I pray, Father, that you would work in the lives of the people here and that you would bring them closer to yourself, that you would reveal who you are to them. We thank you, Father, that you are so worthy of praise and so worthy of becoming the image of you, that we would seek, that we would hunger and thirst after your righteousness, that we would see who you are in your word, and that we would want to emulate you and be just like you. I pray, Father, that you would reveal more of that to us, more of who you are, so that we can be more like you. Thank you, Father. Amen.